There, it's, you know where it is, right? There's a different kinds.
Hey.
Oh, Charles, I forgot to tell Charles.
Hey, so, I'm back to you today.
Hi.
Yeah, no, no.
That was mean.
I forgot to tell you also Chuck's
not coming. Was mean good?
He's, sick.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
I used them actually. I got one. I love it. Would you mind doing this for me tonight?
They're truly Irish brands.
There's really no resemblance.
Good evening. I'd like to call the Monday, February 27th school committee meeting to order. We will start this evening the way we always do with public comments. Pretty light audience tonight, so I'm thinking we're going to be good there. We do have a quick consent agenda to approve. We'll move on to reports. Then we are very lucky to have Principal Sprung and Christine Ty Lux here from Joshua Eaton to talk about the Joshua Eaton School Improvement Plan. Then we're transitioning to something that sadly impacts Eaton as well, which is the search for a new principal. And then Dr. Doherty will take us through district goals as well. I believe that's it for this evening. So I will ask if there's public comment this evening. Seeing none, do I have a motion on the consent agenda?
I move.
Ooh, I lied.
I do.
We have to ask if anything should be removed from the consent agenda.
Yes.
That's what we have to do. Did you have anything
yes.
to remove?
Okay. Yes. The
minutes of January 12th and the minutes of February 6th.
I had wanted to move the minutes of January 26th. So that's all of them. And I think...
Just the field trip.
Well, the minutes. I think, Dr. Doxer, you and I had both briefly spoken with Linda. We were going to work offline because I think the edits are beyond quick little ones, correct?
Actually, well, mine, I've already given them
okay.
To Linda, so that's fine with me.
Okay. If I email you my edits, can you combine them and can we do these minutes at our next meeting? Okay. Thanks, everybody. So those three sets of minutes are removed from the consent agenda. I don't think so. No, anyone can remove, any one person can remove from the consent agenda without a vote. So if you could make a motion,
yep.
The consent agenda as amended.
Motion to approve the consent agenda as amended.
Second.
All those in favor? It's 5-0. Thank you. Reports. Alex, you've been back to school for one whole day. What's
yeah.
going on?
Well, February break was last week. Also, this coming weekend, March 3rd, 4th, and 5th, the Drama Club is putting on a production of 1776. Also, lots of good news with sports. A lot of teams made it to the tournament, girls basketball, boys ice hockey, and girls ice hockey. And they are playing, girls basketball is actually playing right now at Central Catholic. Boys hockey is going to be playing Wednesday, but everything's to be determined. And girls hockey is playing against Hingham at Burbank at 7 p.m. on Saturday. Also, we have... Indoor track, girls indoor track did really well this year. Seven runners and throwers made it to the state tournament. Shannon Parks advanced to all states. She's a thrower, she does shot put. And there were two league all-stars, Shannon Parks and Maeve Swanton. Also in wrestling, they did very well. Trevor Morton finished second in the state and Darren Driscoll finished fifth. And lastly, gymnastics finished seventh in the state. They had an undefeated season. And they were the Middlesex League champions. And also Emily Eagleson, she placed second on beam at states, sixth on floor, and fifth in the all around. So they did very well. That's it.
That's wonderful. That's all very good and exciting news. I just like to say that I like the high school production updates from the Drama Club. I'm really impressed by how many other members of the community get excited about those plays. A lot of I know a lot of elementary aged and middle school aged kids who really are interested in colonial American history and are definitely excited to come see that production. That feels like that happens every year. There's one or two plays that really gets a lot of excitement. So it's great. Anything from the committee?
I just actually I want to add on to that. When I was in my role as author of school notes, I interviewed the director and the people that organize those programs, and that's by intent because they want those programs, the theater programs, to draw the younger kids. It's an opportunity to introduce them to theater and their families, and it really works in our town.
It does. It's great. And for some parents, it's a very affordable way to access the theater.
Yes.
Going into the city can be very expensive. This can be an affordable way to do it. So.
Yeah, and it works for the older kids and it works for the younger kids.
It's great. Yes,
so
Mr. Nine. Dr. Nine.
Reading hosted the All-State Wrestling Tournament for the second time. And for the second time, I've heard nothing but accolades from people in the sport outside of Reading throughout the state. In terms of the organization and how smoothly it went. So, you know, kudos to Tom Zayer and the wrestling program, coaches and wrestlers who are the ones that are responsible for putting it on.
That's wonderful, thanks. any other reports from the committee, Mrs. Webb?
I just wanted to highlight, Dr. Daugherty does a weekly publication called The Journey. We're in volume 8 of The Journey. Which is 8 years, by the way, and number 24. And I just wanted to highlight the wonderful article that you wrote on Molly Callahan and her recognition by the Parker community. I think it was really amazing. She's a young woman that has really come through so many amazing struggles. and persisted and is such a role model and an inspiration to people. So I thought it was excellent, and I think people might have also seen there was some local news coverage of Christopher Bear McFarland on the hockey team, and I think it was again a great things to highlight. In addition to really the rest of the journey also is always filled with really important things for our teachers, our staff, and also always highlighting the students and the impact our teachers have on students. So I just really wanted to highlight those two items tonight.
Dr. Doherty, I don't recall if at our last meeting we updated on the Finance Committee meeting that we attended. And if we didn't, were you going to discuss that tonight, or would you like me to? I know, I can't write. I made a note.
I don't think so.
I don't think so either. I think it was before break. Anyway,
yeah,
I brought it up, so I'll discuss it. I'll give it as a report. Dr. Doxer, Mrs. Webb, myself, Dr. Doherty, and Ms. Dowd were able to meet with the town's finance committee a week and a half ago, 2 weeks ago? In the last 2 weeks.
Yeah.
In the last 3 weeks.
Yeah.
It was really, I thought it was a wonderful discussion. The sort of crux of it, from a school committee perspective, was our passing of an unbalanced budget and requesting a lump of free cash, $438,000, to fund the middle school positions for 1 year, in comparison to the town manager's cogent path forward plan, and sort of what were the differences between those two plans, what were the benefits of each. Certainly no votes were made, no decisions were made, but I was really impressed. I was so impressed I actually emailed the chair. The quality of the discussion, the thoughtfulness of the discussion was excellent. And I certainly felt that every member of the FinCom was very aware of why we made the request and took the kind of exceptional action we took. They were very sensitive to what those middle school cuts meant. So there's clearly going to be a lot of discussion over the next 2 months as we make our way to April town meeting. But I didn't want to update the committee. It was a really impressive conversation. And we were invited to fully engage as well. We spoke a lot.
At the table,
yep.
Literally.
Yeah.
They really invited us in to have a back and forth. It was an excellent meeting. It's on RCTV's YouTube for people who don't get enough meetings. Okay, that's it for me, Mrs. Webb.
Just so tied into that, I just want to highlight, and maybe we're talking about it, we all have updated budget books at our desk, and I believe that was sent out a few days ago. Dr. Doherty and Mrs. Dowd, and primarily Mrs. Dowd, had to really completely rescrub this budget based on these changes, and so that's all updated, and that all went out to the FinCom. I know at our meeting, they were anxious to see the budget, which we were not able to provide at the time because it needed to change.
Sure.
And I really also want to highlight that I think Ms. Borowski did an excellent job on the introductory letters. And I really would, not only would I recommend, I would really ask that for people who are trying to understand what the school budget is about and have questions, I would sincerely ask that people look at these documents and read them and you know, do some work trying to understand it if you have a question. And if it's not clear exactly what's here, come to our meetings at public input and let's talk about it and we can clearly answer the questions. There's really, it's such a thorough document. And it's really important. It's not only thorough, it's really important that the community understand the foundation of this document and this budget and the situation that we are in as a community from our schools and all of our municipal services. So I thank you to Dr. Doherty and Ms. Dowd and Ms. Borowski. And again, just a request to the public to please utilize the document to its full extent, and it's on the website, along with like every other
yes,
presentation.
We did update it on the website, yes.
Right, and every other presentation that was made during the budget process.
All of our meetings are on YouTube.
Right.
I just wanted to add that people shouldn't feel intimidated by it because it's a very readable
mm-hmm.
and understandable document.
Mm-hmm.
It's written in order to engage people in understanding why the decisions are made and what the resources are.
Thanks.
Thank you for doing that, all the work that it takes.
Truly, thank you. Anything else from the committee? Yeah.
Human Relations Advisory Committee meets on March 2nd. We have a special guest coming. Senator Jason Lewis is coming to discuss with us our future structure of our committee, as well as the human rights resolution that was just discussed at the selectmen's meeting on February 21st. So everybody is invited to join us. It's the police station, Thursday, March 2nd at 7. And then also there's a Massachusetts Human Rights Commission, Massachusetts Association of Human Rights Commissions meeting on Friday, this Friday, from 9:30 to 11:30 at Medford. I go to them if someone's interested in joining me. I'm lonely in my car. Only sometimes. There have been other people that have gone with me too, but it's a great opportunity to meet with people who have been doing this for a while and have insights and are doing all sorts of great programs across the state. Second report. The CPAC has been very busy. They've updated their website, and it's off of our Reading Public Schools website. And they have announced a number of events that are coming up. This Wednesday, March 1st, the famed Dr. Olivardia, I don't know if I'm pronouncing his name right, but he just presented a couple of months ago about ADD and dyslexia, and he was amazing, and he filled the room at the library, the new library, to overflowing. I mean, I was sitting on the floor on the side, and there were lots of people leaning against the walls. He was fabulous. And he is offering a webinar on Wednesday, this Wednesday, called Attitude, ADDITUDE. And so the information's on their new website. Check it out. Keep checking it out, because they announce programs from all of the surrounding communities, not just Reading. And then also on March 11th, there's going to be a meeting of the CPAC here in the superintendent's conference room. And Laura Gem, our town clerk, is going to come and do an open committee training. And anybody is welcome to come if you really want to understand what the rules are that bind and that liberate us. Open meeting law. What did I say?
Open committee.
Oh, I meant open meeting law. I'm sorry. Thank you for correcting me. So if you really want to understand some of the rules around how the committees operate, this will be a great opportunity. The meeting starts at 9. Ms. Gem will be there between 9 and 9:30, and it will go till around 11. So please come.
It's obviously AM.
AM, yes. Saturday morning.
CPAC has done an awful lot this year, and it's really a credit to Ms. Wilson and to the parents who've stepped up and volunteered, and you've been a really, Dr. Doxer, you've been a very engaged liaison to them, so it's very exciting to see websites being built and a lot of good momentum there.
A lot of good discussion.
Yeah. Is that it from the committee? Mm-hmm. All right.
Okay. I have a few items. First, I want to read a joint press release that the Chief Sigala and I sent out today regarding the break-in at the high school early this morning. At this point, there is no other information, so I'm just going to read the joint press release. Chief Sigala, Superintendent Daugherty report that the Reading Police Department has charged a student with breaking and entering into the high school overnight. A 16-year-old juvenile male is charged with breaking and entering in the nighttime with the intent to commit a felony, breaking and entering into a depository, possession of burglarious tools, and receiving stolen property under $250. On Monday, February 27th, just after midnight, police responded to Reading Memorial High School, 62 Oakland Road, and report that a burglar alarm was activated. Upon arrival, police began checking the doors to the building and noticed a male wearing a black hooded sweatshirt wandering the halls. Reading Fire Department and Massachusetts State Police K-9 unit also responded to the scene. Reading police, with the assistance from the State Police K-9 unit, entered the school. After announcing their presence, police saw the male run down the hallway toward a stairwell with a black backpack in his hand. Police were then able to make contact with the suspect, identified as the juvenile male, outside the cafeteria. And inside the backpack, police found burglarious tools, cash, a wallet, and other items. And then the juvenile male will be summoned to Middlesex County Juvenile Court in Lowell at a later date. As I said, we don't have any other further information to report at this time, but I felt it was important that I read that tonight. And when we get more information, certainly we will bring it forward.
Thank you for getting that press release out so quickly. I mean, that really within a matter of hours, and I know you had to work closely with Chief Sagala.
Yeah.
It's another example of their excellent work and how grateful we are to have them in our community, but also how good it is that you and he have such a strong working relationship. That
we were on the phone as early as 6 o'clock this morning with, and our facilities department was actually here, had to come in at about 1 o'clock this morning, in dealing with the situation as well.
Well, thanks to everyone, all of you who stepped in to do that. Did you have something, Mrs.
I just, was there any damage, property damage, or are we into the school?
No, there was no damage to the school. I do want to talk just briefly about the, you had brought up the budget document. So you received, I believe, three documents. You received the replacement document for the school committee budget. You received the Munis version of that document, and you also received an updated version of the questions. And as we receive more questions, we will be adding to that document and continuing to repost it on the website. So, you know, and as Mrs. Webb said, I do want to thank Gail. Gail did the bulk of the work, so I want to thank her for all of her time and effort on this. And I know this process is going to continue, but she's done an unbelievable job for her first budget. The amount of work that she's put in has been amazing. So I just wanted to, and to that, the town manager released his budget to the finance committee last week. One of the things that we had met with the town manager about a month ago, maybe even
a
month and a half, 2 months ago, and we had a discussion about how could we make the format similar. And I think you'll notice when you see the town manager's budget and the school department budget, it's very similar in format this year.
Wow.
Again, we're trying to make the documents look similar. Obviously, you're comparing apples and oranges, and there are things that are going to be a little bit different based on the needs of each budget. But I think you'll see that the format, there's a lot of similarities in the format.
I think town meeting will respond positively to that.
Yeah.
So you're saying we're going to get, as town meeting members, we're not just going to have the Munis for the municipal side?
No, the budget that was sent out is more than that.
Oh, outstanding. I've been a long time town meeting member.
Yeah, that's great.
That'll be excellent.
And let's see, I think, the other piece is, at Ms. Borowski's request, I contacted town council about communication when the chair is responding to a citizen sending information out. What is the best approach in terms of making sure that everyone on the committee receives that response to make sure that we're conforming with the open meeting policy? And so what we are going to do, we are actually going to follow what is done on the town side and have a correspondence section now as part of your packet from this point forward. So anytime the chair is responding to email that is sent to the committee, then that response will be printed in the packet the following time. To that end, I do want, at your desk, there is our first one under the new system, so I wanted to make sure that you had it from a town meeting member with a list of questions about the budget, which we, Ms. Borowski, responded to, as you can see there. She also sent an email, a separate email, making another set of requests to me, which we will also be working on, but I wanted you to have that as well. Just wanted to give you that as information. And from this point forward, it will be in your packet. Given the timeliness of that this came out last week, we wanted you to have it. And that is all I have.
John, I have a question about that. I haven't looked at the school committee link on the website recently. Is there, my only, not concern, but something I'd like to protect against, is putting something on the website that says, if you email the school committee, your email and the response will be published. Because I could see someone emailing and not knowing or expecting that their name and their, what they wrote is going to be public record, even though it is, by law, public record. Is there a way that we could put something on the website just so that...
Let me see what I can do.
Thank you.
Yep.
Yeah, thanks. Dr. Doxer?
I just wanted to clarify that, like this, it will be both the letter that's submitted as well, or the email that's submitted as well as the response.
That's what's there.
Right, I know it's here,
yes,
but that's what we're saying. Going forward, it will be both
that's
letters
correct.
And the...
Yes.
Thank you.
Yep. I just want to reiterate a point, and it's sort of relative to the requests that were made, but and to the amazing detail of this budget. And I just really want to make sure that we understand that there's an opportunity cost when these questions are being answered. And of course, that was the full expectation during the budget process. And I think there's something like, is there a total of 90 questions so far that have been asked and answered?
Yeah, I think so, 90, 93 or something.
And so again, I just really want to ask people who have questions to please do the work of looking at what's there and leveraging that information, because it costs time and money when we're asking Dr. Daugherty or Mrs. Dowd or Carolyn or Craig, or you know, to be re-answering questions that have been answered. So I just really urge, I think the budget documents are as easy to understand as possible. Mm-hmm. And we have to make sure that we are the people who are supposed to be watching, you know, how the resources are being utilized to achieve the goals of the district. The goals of the district are student outcomes, and we need to, you know, make sure we're protecting against it. So I just really want to emphasize that point.
That's all
it?
I have. Thank you.
All right. 4 minutes early. Can't wait to hear what's going on at Eaton.
So I'll certainly jump right in. I was here, it was about a month ago, where I provided just some information and just sort of a timeline of what's been happening over the course of this year. Christine was nice enough to join me again today. So Christine is the co-chair of the school council, so she and I work very closely together, certainly within our meeting structure that we have, but we also meet on a regular basis, and she provides an opportunity for me to have a sounding board just in terms of the parent perspective and understanding what the goals and objectives of the community and how they align with the school. And so that partnership has certainly been very helpful for me, and as we like to say, we have a brutally honest relationship with each other where we can share information, and certainly ultimately that really helps the school and continues us moving forward. So I certainly appreciate that with Christine. A month ago, I provided a lot of data and information about why decisions are happening, and really in the last month, what I'm gonna share with you today is sort of the work that's come based on that data. So you're gonna see mostly just about the workflow that's been happening. So I'll be sharing that information with you, and then I have some additional thoughts just in terms of the transition, obviously, in terms of the announcement as well. So just as I mentioned a month ago, when we uncovered some of the data regarding literacy, we made some decisions, and we needed to have a better way to collect the data and collect the information. So we collected all of our benchmark data and analyzed the results and recognized that the challenge was really from kindergarten through third grade in terms of the instruction that was happening at those levels and the success of those students. And so our kindergarten through third grade teachers received a training on a new reading program that we felt was going to be really beneficial and create a really appropriate flow of instruction that happens starting in kindergarten and goes through grade five. And what we had seen is that there were just some inconsistencies of what the instruction looked like from year to year to year. And by having the program that we have selected, we're ensuring that there's gonna be that flow of instruction happens grade to K to three. So Tricia Stodden has done that training with our K to three teachers. And then following up on that training is doing model lessons in classrooms. And that started today, where she actually is going into classrooms, and the reading specialist are going into classrooms and modeling what the program should look like, how mini lessons should happen, how individual conferences with students can happen, how to differentiate the instruction so we can ensure that the students in grades K-1, 2, and 3 are getting a consistent instruction that ultimately will flow for those students going from grades K through 3, which I think is certainly going to be beneficial for them. And it's based on the writer's workshop model. So the writer's workshop model that we have now that's run by Lucy Calkins allows for individual conferences with teachers and students together that really targets what the individual needs of students are. And that's why this writing, with this reading program is going to be successful as well, because we're looking at individual needs of students, and students are getting targeted instructions that are going to ultimately move them through the levels on their assessments that we have. And then, ideally, what we have then, once the instruction happens in an effective manner, you're getting a better correlation of the assessment that we're providing with PARC or MCAS, which is what we're obviously shifting to. So by doing this quality instruction, getting good data from the assessment, and then ultimately knowing that the assessment is going to have a good correlation with how our students are going to do on MCAS, and that's what we're looking for. So in order for this program to happen effectively, we needed additional resources. So we purchased several thousand dollars worth of books for independent reading, so kids can have the text at their level that they're gonna read on a daily basis, and so that was one thing that happened. And then teachers also needed the resources from the program, so we purchased the teacher resources as well from this program that was essential for their training. In approximately 3 or 4 weeks, we're gonna do a check-in with the teachers. So we've provided them an opportunity certainly to get the training to start off with, but often when teachers get training, they have a good start, but then they're gonna need additional training because they start to learn what are the challenges and struggles that they're facing. So we are gonna have some additional time where teachers are gonna get, where they're gonna have time where they can determine this is where I feel confident and this is where I know that I'm doing well in terms of my instruction, and these are the areas that I still need assistance and support with. And then Tricia will provide that training for those teachers, and it's gonna be more targeted. So we start off, you do a global training if this is what you need to get started, and then in 3 or 4 weeks, you can more individualize the training for teachers based on where they are and what they need going forward. We also looked at our intervention time for students. So anytime a student is struggling or having difficulty with literacy, often the classroom instruction is gonna be critically important, but then they're gonna need something additional on top of what they have. So we have reallocated our tutors to make sure they're using a specific program that is targeted for our students that need additional information. So there's something called an LLI program, which is aligned with the benchmark assessment, and it requires students to get daily intervention, and it's a very structured and scripted program that ultimately is going to help those students that require additional support, and our tutors are being able to deliver that instruction on top of what's happening within the classroom. And our fourth and fifth grade teachers have been going around the district and watching other teachers within Reading do some really good quality writing instruction, and so Mr. Martin was able to set up some opportunities where teachers from around the district are going to visit other teachers within Reading, because we have some really strong teachers here, and we have opportunities where our teachers were able to go and watch what Reading lessons look like in those classrooms. So that's sort of been, over the last month, the literacy shift. Our other goal this year is around communication. So our school council is looking at how we are communicating and how we're making information available for parents. And we have had meetings with our communication team to look at what our website content is available, what website content we have available, and how that information gets posted, and then making sure that that information is up to date. Are we removing content that's old? Are we putting information on the front page that is most relevant for parents? And then how do we keep and maintain the website to ensure that information is accurate? How are information from our school council meetings, making sure that information is there, and other committee meetings, ensure our notes and content is available. In 2015, there was a lot of shifts and changes that were happening at Josh Reading, there was a survey that was done That was a communication survey. It was the year prior to me being there. And that was a catalyst for helping create some school improvement plan goals around communication. The school council has reviewed that survey, and we are in the process of creating another communication survey with the school council to see how we made improvements in 2015. We believe we've made some good improvements, but we also know that in terms of communication, there's always more to do. And so we're gonna do a survey, hopefully in the spring, in the next month or two, that will say, look, this is things that are going well. This is what the school has done well. What can teachers continue to do to make sure they're communicating effectively to parents? And so that's something that is gonna be happening coming from our school council. With special education, with the support of Carolyn Wilson, we did a number of things to look at our staffing, and we noticed that the caseload for our special education teachers, the amount of testing that was required, and just in terms of service delivery grade, they had some pretty high caseload, so we were fortunate that we were able to hire another special education teacher, and that person has started and helped make more manageable caseloads for our special education teachers. This is Learning Center teachers. This is separate from the Bridge program, but this is really working within our Learning Center. And then last week, right before vacation, we had a training from Alan Bloom. So Alan Bloom is a consultant that does some work, and he's worked in all the different levels. He has helped the staff at Josh Wheaton look at what our IEP service delivery grids look like. So what we have found is that many of our service delivery grids have a high number of students that are getting what we call our C-grid services, where students are pulled out of the classroom. And there's reasons for that, and when kids' IEPs require that or their learning needs require that, it's certainly a helpful thing to happen. But often we find that we can find ways for kids to get into the classroom and get support in the classroom, and what are the decision-making process that we're using with families to determine, are we doing B services in the classroom, are we doing C services pull out, and what's the right thing to do, and how do we write goals and objectives that are aligned with the service delivery grid. And that's something that Alan Bloom helped in terms of having conversations with our staff about what that's gonna look like. So ultimately, and then how that work happens with teachers, because when kids are in the classroom, you want teachers and the special education staff to work collaboratively together in terms of those services. So he did a full day training with our Bridge program, and our Learning Center staff and the team chair were there together as part of that training. I talked a lot about the after school program. Last month, the program is still moving along in a very successful manner. We have about a month left. Certainly, the data we're collecting now is just regarding on a week-to-week basis. The kids are going through the program, but we'll certainly know more once the MCAS results come back from those students. MCAS preparation, the state has now released the practice questions, so we're going through some of those practice questions, which is certainly helpful, and they also released the tutorials, which help for students so they have a good understanding of how to use the computer, work through some of those questions. So we put together a schedule where kids are going to be now getting on the computers, doing those practice tests and running through those tutorials, and making sure not only is the technology working appropriately, but the kids are comfortable with what is going to be on those MCAS tests. We have a wonderful WASH committee, and the WASH committee, one of their things that they've been thinking about is mindfulness. I know it's been a big conversation that's happened within this district. And they are excited that they were able to secure Dr. Christopher Willard, who's written lots of books and done some presentations with Sarah Bird around mindfulness, and he's gonna be coming to Parker on March 14th at 7 o'clock. Because what the WASH committee, and I know Christine feels this way in terms of the school council, we obviously have a lot invested in terms of the student results when it comes to their academics, but also how kids feel. And the stress level that they have and what that implications are for that at home as well as at school. And so the WASH committee feels very passionately that mindfulness is something we have to be thinking about. And so they're invested in bringing in classroom resources as well. So we have two staff members that have done some extensive training around mindfulness and use it in their classrooms on a pretty consistent basis, and so they're going to be actually working with some of their colleagues and show them how mindfulness looks like in their classrooms and how we can help bring that to all the classes that we have. I'm also looking at attendance data. Certainly we do review attendance data on a regular basis, certainly required by law, making sure we're communicating out to families when there's a large number of absences and tardies. We want to make sure that we're doing everything we can to ensure that kids are getting the appropriate level of support so they feel comfortable in school. Can we figure out ways to get them to school on time? What are the challenges that parents are facing in terms of attendance? Because ultimately that's going to have a big impact for us, because learning starts right away and we want kids to be there. And so we've done a lot with student attendance, making sure we have supports that are going to be there. So that's the other thing that we've been looking at. So these are the big areas that we've been focusing on over the last month. And just a quick sense of what the next steps are for us as a school. I talked about the model lessons that are being done in reading and writing by Tricia Stodd, and that's having a really positive impact. Certainly anytime you bring about change in a school, that can be stressful time for teachers because they really want to do their best work. And so they want to make sure they're implementing anything that's new, anything they've been trained on in the best way possible. So they need support. And so being able to do model lessons is certainly going to be helpful. I mentioned that the MCAS trainings and practice tests leading up to the spring administration are going to be taking place. The Eaton staff are observing other teachers in the area of writing. We've been having some conversations, and I have principal coffees periodically, and one of the principal coffees, the conversation come up is how does our library media program support the reading work that we're doing? So we're setting up a conversation with the library media specialist. Teachers and parents are gonna come together and talk about what role should the library media program play when it comes to supporting reading instruction. And so those conversations are beginning as well. The data analysis, I talked a little bit about. We do the benchmark just completed, but for students that are part of the LLI program because they need interventions, we do progress monitor them on a regular basis to make sure that the program is working and that they're making progress as we go. We're looking at preparedness of Eaton students from grade 5 to Parker. This is something that happens on a regular basis, but based on where Eaton has been academically, we want to make sure, are we falling behind Barrows and Kilm, who also send kids to Parker? How do our kids stack up when they enter middle school? So I've been having email conversations with Rochelle Shanklin to talk about what are things that she's noticing just in terms of her staff. Anecdotally, she hasn't seen anything at this point in the conversations that I've had with her, but she's gonna be going through the data with me, and then we're gonna have a meeting with the staff at Parker and parents at Eaton so they're clear and they have an understanding of these are all the things that you can do as families to help transition your kids, and these are the things that they look for as kids transition from Eaton to Parker. So we've had those conversations that have started. The special education staff, we're continuing training for them just in terms of IEP development, making sure we're looking at how we're collaborating and sharing resources with the classroom teachers and special education teachers to do more co-teaching. So those trainings are going to be taking place between now and the end of the year, making sure that the program that we have, the IEP needs and state curriculum frameworks are matching up. So what we often find is kids' IEP goals are very individualized, which is great, because that's what we want to make sure happens, but we also want to make sure that the IEP goals also match curriculum framework, because that's what the standard is that we have for all our students. We want them to be able to access the grade level curriculum. And then we have an open house scheduled in March, and we're also going to have an open house opportunity for our music classes. So our two new music teachers are going to invite parents to come in and watch what happens in music as well. So that's something that we have planned. So those are some of the next steps that that I foresee taking place. So I just want to give, I have a something I just wanted to share with you regarding transition, and then I'll open it up to questions. And I wrote something that I just wanted to share. So I want to certainly thank you for allowing me to provide an update on Joshua Eaton. And I'm going to share some personal thoughts just reflecting on my time in Reading. It was approximately 8 years ago when I came to Reading Public Schools for the opportunity to work at Birch Meadow. And the school was going through a transition that some viewed as a challenge. And when I saw the school, I didn't look at it as a challenge, but it was really an opportunity. The school was full of energy, and the focus of everything that happened in that building was based on helping and supporting students. Over the years, we had visitors from many places across the state, from across the country, the Massachusetts Secretary of Education come, and it was rewarding being a principal where I witnessed firsthand student ambassadors who bragged to visitors about their school. The parents were very supportive of the work. They led programs and supported their teachers. And the teachers were equally as passionate about keeping the focus of their love of students and recognizing that caring about students is just as important as teaching them. And all of the success at Birch Meadow is a product of that community. Teachers, students, parents, they are the catalyst for an amazing school environment that is unwavering in their support of each other. So this made the transition for me to Joshua Eaton a difficult decision. But I felt connected to Birch Meadow, but having an opportunity to support Joshua Eaton that was also going through a transition was a unique opportunity. Many of the same foundational supports that are part of the school were there just as they were at Birch Meadow. Strong teachers, supportive parents, and a wonderful group of students. And it excites me to work every day in a building where the school is a great foundation and we support the academic needs of students. And just as with Birch Meadow, the group of teachers are passionate about helping students, and I have the opportunity to work with parents that channel their support in a positive direction, and the students are wonderful. This is what makes the school a great place for now and for years to come. It's a school that has a strong foundation that when all members of the community work together, great things happen for kids. And I know that the next principal will have the same positive experience that I did. They will see the opportunity for continued success and collaboration that makes Joshua Eaton great. I want to reiterate what I indicated in my letter regarding my decision to leave Reading Public Schools. This decision has nothing to do with anyone or anything related to Reading. It was a decision about me and my family. Working in Newton at the Cabot School is an opportunity that is in my best interest personally and not a reflection of Joshua Eaton, the town of Reading, or Dr. Doherty. Reading Public Schools and Dr. Doherty have been nothing but supportive of me. In the past year alone, the superintendent supported me and Joshua Eaton in the following ways. They provided me instructional help as the literacy coach has actively led changes in the building with her time and training of staff. We hired a full-time team chairperson. We hired a new special education teacher. Funding was set aside for teachers to get trained on new instructional initiatives. Additional materials to implement a new reading program were purchased. We have a no-cost after-school program for identified students. And we have weekly meetings where the superintendent, assistant superintendent, special education director, and myself discuss any additional resources necessary to keep the improvement process moving forward. In my opinion, the superintendent of schools is doing everything possible to support me personally as well as Joshua Eaton. One of the reasons it is hard to leave is due to the support he provides as well as the support I have always felt in this community. And I include the school committee as one of the supporting entities I have worked with in my time here. School committee members, past and present, have shown your support for me and the school system. I recognize the challenging role you play as you value the schools, prioritize needs when not everything can get funded based on resources available, and you show you listen to the teachers, administrators, and community that we all have wants and desires. And despite these challenges, I have personally always felt listened to and that you know that you are doing what you feel is in the best interest of Reading Public Schools. So in conclusion, during my 6 years at Birch Meadow and the past 2 years at Joshua Eaton, I've tried to foster the philosophy of we are all working together. I could have not done it alone. My success is a product of working with positive and supportive teachers, students, parents, and community. So I want to thank you all. I am a better person and principal because of Reading Public Schools. I hope I was able to give this community a small amount of what you provided for me. I am forever grateful, and I know you will continue to be a great place for kids. So thank you.
I'm applauding. So thank you. The thanks should not come in this direction. It should most definitely go in this direction. I have, and I believe I speak for the committee, so much admiration and respect for you as an individual and as an administrator and as an educator. So I wouldn't begrudge anybody making a career decision that just has to be made. We all have to balance all aspects of our life. So I know the committee wishes you the absolute best in your next endeavor, and we know we'll stay in touch and we'll hear great things. But boy, are they lucky to have you, and boy, is it our loss. Community-wide, I've heard how devastated people are that you're not going to stay here. So, we wish you well. You just are so very respected in this community, and thank you for all you've done for the Reading Public Schools. You're leaving them better and stronger than you found them. And the success that I know we are going to have in the next couple of years, we won't forget. You get a lot of credit for it. So thank you. You sure you're going to go?
Can we change your mind?
All right.
You don't love the long commute in the traffic and you
late nights.
That was exciting.
Be able to walk to school now.
Right.
I actually did, unless people want to talk about the transition, I did have a couple questions about your
presentation.
Did anyone else in the committee?
Yes.
Yeah, go ahead, Dr. Nine.
Just you mentioned the caseloads for the special education teachers. Can you tell us what the average caseload is?
We were running close to 20 students for two learning center teachers. So by having three, we're now able to provide, to spread that out. And it's not just about numbers, it's really about the service delivery grid. So we had some pretty high, not only were the numbers of students high, but also the amount of services in the grids was pretty extensive. So that was able to spread those out as well.
I had a question about the reading program.
Yeah.
So is that new reading program district-wide, or is it sort of being piloted at Eaton?
Craig, you want to meet you to respond, or do you want to respond?
I didn't know who to address.
Yeah, no, that's a fair question.
I would say that things are sort of expedited. We're still exploring the district-wise. Somewhat it's a pilot, but one of the things that we're looking at with the standards is the reading-writing connection, which is very explicit in the new standards. And we feel that a workshop approach, a model, needs to be happening instructionally. And so some of the materials and resources that Mr. Sprung talked about, Eaton is the only one. Well, we have a few teachers in pockets that have requested to try out some things, but mostly Eaton is the school that's trying that out. So I think, does that
Yeah,
that
so
yeah.
It is possible that if it's successful, it might be moved district-wide, or it may not. You're just sort of...
Yeah, so we're still exploring that.
Okay.
And I'm hoping a little bit later in the spring, then we're kind of looking at options. We're kind of looking at a 2 to 3 year plan. Right now, most of the schools, we're focusing on the writing component because that's been a portion that we felt really needed to be addressed because the state standards really emphasize that, the three different types of writing. Mm-hmm. And so to really include instructional time at every grade level to address writing. And then we want to see how that writing then is really linking with the reading and complementing each other.
Makes sense.
We're also, by the way, talking with other districts and the approaches that they have been using, the resources that they have been using with that. And so there are several surrounding communities that are sort of in similar places as we are with that. So we should have some more updates on that in the next month or two.
I had an opportunity to see a writing workshop model at the elementary level a few months ago with you in a fourth grade classroom, and I was tremendously impressed, absolutely blown away by the quality of the writing and by how independent the kids were working. The teacher was a true facilitator. She was walking around the room. Those kids were all engaged. They were all working, and the quality of writing was far above what I was producing in fourth grade by a mile. It was I really was reading their writing going, are they really, fourth grader wrote this? It was incredible. But I do like that model, and so the idea of transitioning that into reading instruction I have an inherently positive reaction to that. So I'll be kind of looking forward to see how that goes.
Yeah, if I could just add too, I mean, one of the lessons that we just saw recently, Mr. Sprung talked about giving teachers opportunities to observe each other, and it doesn't necessarily mean that, oh, they're seeing a more expert or teacher, but sometimes there are people, some of our curriculum leaders, our teacher leaders, who might be a little farther along or might have had some opportunities to attend some other PD that some others haven't had. It's just been wonderful to see that dynamic. And a couple weeks ago, before break, we were in a fourth grade classroom. And again, it's just amazing to see kids writing about text, to see how that the reading and writing are really linked. And not just the writing, but how they are speaking to each other. And I mean, the critical thinking. I mean, I was a eighth grade English teacher, and I saw fourth graders write and interact with each other in ways that years ago I would have been trying to get seventh or eighth graders to do without any exaggeration. And the kids were absolutely engaged and loving it. And, you know, a couple of these lessons have been on Friday afternoons we've seen, and the kids were not looking at the clock. Thinking that they were engaged and enjoying what they were doing. So
I taught 10th grade English. Some of my students who were struggling were more at an 8th grade level, and you're absolutely right.
Yeah.
That is not an exaggeration, what you just said.
Yeah.
It was
really
impressive.
So it's very exciting, some of that work that the teachers are doing. So kudos to them.
Absolutely. Yeah, Dr. Nine.
So what does it look like when they're using the new reading curriculum, when you said there's a lot of one-on-one work going on? So what are the remaining students doing at that time?
Yeah, so the first thing that would happen in the lesson is you would see a 10 to 15 minute focused mini lesson where they're working on a specific skill. And then the students would then have books and materials that are at their level. And while the kids are reading books at their independent level, the teacher's going around and then conferencing either with individual students or with groups of students, or the kids are doing some shared reading. And so part of the work of the mini lesson is having conversations about, during the mini lesson, we just talked about a specific aspect of characterization. And so when you are reading independently, this is the kind of work that, and the kinds of things that you should be thinking about as you're reading, and then the teacher will check in on the students that are reading independently, or if they're doing a shared reading, the kids are now having conversations with each other about what the characterization or the specific skill that they had just worked on. So that's what that should look like, and then they do at the end of that time of the reading block, then the kids come back together and they sort of do a debrief about what are the things that you read, what are the things you talked about, what did you work on with your partner, and that's the kind of the collective component that when the kids come back together.
How does that look with kindergartners though?
Yeah, so it's a matter of building up stamina, so that's one of the first things you do. You might not have a full hour-long block necessarily with kindergartners. You might have to have a shorter block where you do the 10 to 15-minute lesson. You start off with maybe 5 to 10 minutes of independent reading, and then you do, you know, a coming back together lesson. It's just a matter of how you break up the time for the younger ones, but ultimately you want them over time. And what we've seen happen, there's some teachers at Birch Meadow that are doing this, they actually can almost make it the full 20 to 30 minutes where they're working independently or working with partners doing that work.
At kindergarten?
Yep. Yes.
And so some of them can make that. What happens to the others who just aren't developmentally there yet, how does that process work? Where do they get their support?
Yeah, so we look at the staffing. So often there, not only is the classroom teacher there, but then there's also a tutor that's in the room that is spending some additional time for the kids that need more help and more support, that they require more frequent check-ins because they'll lose their focus or they'll, you know, their minds will start to wander. Those kids will get more frequent opportunities to have those conversations with teachers, or their small group will spend a little bit longer together with an adult because we recognize that they can't sustain themselves independently for as long as they can.
Do the paraprofessionals help in that as well, the kindergarten paras?
In kindergarten, the paraprofessionals certainly will help with that. The tutors, the reading tutors will do that as well.
Dr. Nye.
It's sort of a universal question. Maybe it would be something Craig or John, yourself, maybe would be able to answer to, but I constantly hear concerns about teachers being out of their classroom, and, you know, is, you know, a education? Is there continuity going on? How does that, I mean, I understand fully the value of going in and observing other teachers, but how is that, you know, how do you balance that?
Yeah, I think it's a challenge. Certainly you want to make sure that there's continuity for kids, but you also know that in order for effective change to happen, teachers need opportunity to have, whether it's, you know, time with you know, Tricia Stodden or whoever it is that's doing that training or observing other classrooms. How do you do it in smaller amounts of time so you're not losing multiple days in a row, or can you do it in a half day rather than in full days? I guess I would make the argument that figuring out, they're ultimately going to benefit kids if you give teachers the opportunity to collaborate and work together. So finding, I think it's critically important, even if it, you know, maybe there's a half a day where there's a sub in there where maybe you feel like the instruction isn't as continuous or whatever it happens to be working. But I think ultimately is going to have long-term benefits because now the teachers are really in line with what the instructional practice is. And I think the teachers value that time together. So we have to continue to find ways to support them where they can meet together, even if there are those times where the sub is in there and it the review, it's more review work as opposed to continuing the education.
Do you get that question asked?
Yeah, I mean, it comes up periodically. It's just a matter of helping people understand what's the value of teachers working together and collaborating together and being and growing them professionally. I think it's not only I get it asked from parents, but I also get it asked during interviews from teachers. How do we continue to grow professionally? What opportunities do I have to work with my colleagues? It's one of the most common questions we get when we're doing interviews with staff.
And I agree completely. I mean, I think it's very important. I mean, it is, but you're right. I mean, it's that balance. You know, the goal has to be that if a teacher is participating in one of those opportunities, that it is absolutely valuable, that will have a positive impact on kids when they return to their classroom. I mean, we've also been using a model more and more, and I think as we plan forward, we'll even be using it more, as Eric mentioned, sort of a part day, a half a day. I mean, some of the lessons that we were just talking about are basically teachers are out of the classroom for a couple hours, 2 hours, maybe three at the most. And the feedback we've gotten from teachers, that's been very valuable. Essentially, it consists of sort of a pre-lesson sort of discussion, like, you know, what are we going to be seeing today? What's it about? Actually observing a lesson with the kids. And it always just amazes me, by the way, you could have eight adults in there, and after 2 minutes, the kids really don't care. They just go on with what they would be doing. And then having sort of a debrief afterwards, which is really inspiring to listen to have professionals, you know, talking and learning from each other. The one that I was just talking about, the fourth grade lesson, we even had a couple of the middle school teachers that wanted to attend, a couple sixth grade teachers who were bringing it back to their colleagues at their last PLC, you know, beginning their meeting by saying, oh my God, I wish you guys could have seen the fourth grade lesson. Because basically they're realizing we're going to be inheriting kids like this. Mm-hmm. You know, this is impacting us, and here's what I saw. And that's really powerful. So when it has that sort of impact, when I hear of teachers using words like inspirational, you know, to see how the kids, this one particular teacher was saying, I went up to one little girl and said, how can you sustain, you know, you're writing for so long? And all the she could have asked any of the kids, but the student said, I just have so much to say. They're writing and writing. So that's great to see that interaction among colleagues.
One last question.
Sure.
How does the Lucy Calkins reading program vary from what was been used in the past, which I often hear used as guided reading? Mm-hmm. I know we don't necessarily have a reading curriculum in place, but mm-hmm. a lot of different things going on. How does it vary from what was going on previously at Eaton? Or even like what's going on, how it compares to where it was at Birch Meadow?
Yeah, I think the biggest shift is the individualized component that the workshop model provides, and the ability to do structured lessons daily are the two biggest things that you'll find different. So guided reading, what happens in guided reading, you get a group of students and you will go through a conversation with a group based on something that the teacher wants to share about a specific topic regarding a book. And so that's what the conversation focus is. When you have an individual workshop model, your focus lesson, that first 10 to 15 minutes, that's where your structured conversation happens, and the whole group hears the information together, and then you work on that skill individually, and the teacher is working individually with students on either the skill that was just taught or something else that is individually geared for where a student is based on their current level of functioning within the reading that they're doing, or the book or the text that they're accessing. So I find that it's more individualized, and it requires the teacher to do instruction daily with the entire group, where with guided reading sometimes you wouldn't get to a group on certain days, and so therefore that group of students would just be continuing with whatever they had been taught the day before, and I think the workshop model requires more instruction time for students, and it also is more individualized.
And I've heard, you know, the term foundations. I actually had the opportunity to see when I was observing a student teacher in Swampscott, and physical education teacher had a cover for the teacher who was going to come in late on a snowy day, and students were going through the foundations, so I got a chance to see it. How does that play into, you know, the phonics? I know that foundations is a phonics program.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that's maintained, or is that something that goes by the wayside? Or
no, that's something we maintain. We look at that as sort of a separate entity, away that's different than the workshop model. We keep that as this program still needs to happen in order to teach the phonics and phonemic awareness skills, and then the workshop model really is focused on fluency comprehension skills.
So it sounds sort of like, you know, there's been the circle of what type of reading programs are best, from whole language to phonics, and sounds like that's a blend. Is that what I'm hearing?
I don't remember back to my whole language days. So I think whole language to me, just from what I remember, is kids had more autonomy and were sort of left to just learn things more organically. And I think this is more structured than whole languages, but certainly. Because we want kids to have targeted instruction, and we want them to have more conversations with teachers so they know what to work on. But certainly, part of education is things often will come around if they seem to be working. And I think this program, the nice thing about this program is obviously the connection to the way we've been doing writing. So I think it naturally fits well with what teachers are comfortable with.
Thanks.
Yeah, so I had a question about continuity. My voice is a little bit off. So continuity horizontal and continuity vertically. So a student going through the program, I heard you talk about the training, I heard you talk about the model lessons, I heard you talk about the resources that we're bringing to kind of inputs to the teaching process. Could you speak a little bit about any other features of this implementation that relate to ensuring that the student experience is going to be as uniform in a good way as possible across the different classes within the school? And then vertically, when a student moves on, so students A and student B were in two different classes in this program this year and next year, they both move on. Now they're in class together to ensure that they're both able to access the next stage, the next grade level of this curriculum. So what measures are you including to achieve those outcomes?
Yeah, the trainings that we do are by grade level, so the teachers hear the same information and they're having conversations with the literacy coach and myself about what does their instruction look like, what does the support look like, and how the implementation looks at, you know, at the grade level. And then after those conversations, when we start talking about model lessons, both teachers, let's say there's two teachers in a grade level, both teachers will then go and observe the model lesson so they can actually see Trisha doing the model lesson. And then one of the teachers will go back, and then they can model the lesson in their classroom. So they actually can watch it right away and then go do it in their own classroom. And you can do that whether there's two or three classes, obviously at a grade level. So they talk about it, they hear it, they get professionally understanding of what it should look like, then they see it modeled, and then they can immediately go back and do it in their own classrooms. And then so periodically, you know, that's what the check-in after 3 or 4 weeks is important, because you want to say, all right, look, what are you seeing? How is it working in your classroom? How's it working in your classroom? Tricia and the reading specialist, they observe all the classrooms, so they can calibrate as well to make sure that what they're observing in the classrooms is consistent with what's been taught. So that's how you do it across the grade level. Now, vertically, that's why we started now, making sure that, look, this is the model and this is the flow of what the program looks like. When you do, I mean, that was one of the challenges with guided reading. There was a lot of flexibility from how teachers did their guided reading groups. This program is very structured and very routine-oriented, where you have the model lessons, the independent reading, the partner work. You know, what does it look like from year to year is very consistent. So we should find that consistency happens year over year, and our fourth and fifth grade teachers are already doing it. So that's why it's doing grades K to three is going to have a positive impact.
Just a couple of things. One is, I remember when we weren't doing any of this work vertically across the grades when my kids were young, and there was lots of discussion about the middle schools not really knowing what the elementary schools had done, and there were disconnects, and I've seen so much progress. It's very impressive. And then personally experienced it when I did some writing workshops at Parker, and I was so impressed with the skills of the kids to work together. And I, one of the things I did with them is I read them something I had written and they critiqued it. And they were sensitive and honest and perceptive, and things that I hadn't thought about they brought out and had grounded it in examples. I was just very impressed, and that comes from the modeling, I think, of what they're doing in their classrooms. One of my questions is, you mentioned about preparation for the MCAS and the PARC and the practice exams that come out, and I hear on the one hand the richness of this workshop model, excuse me, and what these kids are accomplishing and challenging themselves at, and then I hear about test preparation. And so my question is, does the test preparation practice have a quality to it that takes kids in a good, that exercises the right things, that is still teaching them? My concern is that test preparation is a holding pattern because they need to do this on a test. And I want to be assured that they're learning good things, and their inspiration and their creativity, and because I have so much to say, is not being squelched by that practice preparation.
Right. I mean, I will say this over and over again. The best way to prepare for a test is good teaching and good instructional practices that happen in a classroom. So that really is the first and foremost conversation. I mean, the nature, so the one challenge that will get in the way of that is when you're taking a computer-based test and there's specific tools, and the way the format of the test is not something that you can just naturally necessarily make part of your instructional routine. You actually have to see it on the computer, and you have to see what the test looks like. You have to get students familiar with those tools. So you don't want to inundate them, but you want them to be comfortable with that tool. When they take a practice test, the idea being, when we talk about a practice test that the kids are doing, you always refer back to the instruction. So you say to a kid, look, we're doing, you know, a little bit of time on this practice test, but let's use those strategies that we just practiced when we were doing writing and when we were talking about reading. What reading skills are you using during your, that we just taught when you are doing this practice test? What writing skills, you know, are you thinking about as we're doing this writing practice? So they should sort of fit together, because ultimately you want them to see the connection between when they're taking a test and what is all the instruction that just happened. So most of the time I feel it's pretty well connected. The only real roadblock is just using the tools and familiarity with the program.
Yeah, I'd like to just tie together two really good questions that I heard on either side of me. Along a theme of feedback loops, and so the question is this, what was the feedback that we received that prompted this change, right? Obviously there were the level three, and that's, you know, obvious to everybody, and there were some test scores that resulted in that, but were there other considerations in selecting this modified program? And then what, going forward, how do we know it's working? How do we know it's achieving the goals that we've set for it? And that, I think, goes beyond just the test scores and the assessments. I mean, what we want to do is develop our students.
Mm-hmm.
And so I guess, what is the feedback loop that you have in place in the system to, obviously we've heard some of these, right? We have a coach in place, we have teachers collaborating. You know, there's a school committee, you know, is that tasked with assessing what parents think of this, what kids think of this? Is this helpful? Is this enriching our students? How are you assessing all of those, both the quantitative, yeah, we're going to get some test scores, how are we going to hold this program accountable in the area of test scores, but also beyond that, what are the other things we're measuring to decide when is it going to work, and how long is that assessment period? Is it a year? Is it 2 years? Is it 3 years? How do you view that? So first is, what led to this? Second is, how are we going to know if this works?
Mm-hmm. So what led to this? I mean, I think you sort of hit on it with just in terms of the correlation between the work that was happening in the classroom and the assessment. Our teachers are working really hard and doing some really good teaching practices based on their knowledge and understanding, but the results that we were getting with students was not what should match. And so that was really the catalyst for the change, is that when you realize that more than 50% of your population are not meeting grade level benchmark, you know, you have to make some shifts. So we, you know, I certainly worked with Mr. Martin and Trisha Stodden to say, look, what are programs that are out there that can get us some really good results with individual students based on individual needs, and we have to start in kindergarten. It can't just be waiting till third grade. We have to start early on. So that was really the catalyst for the change. As far as growth, we look at the you need to know, I mean, I hate to say it, but you need to know that the numbers are going to improve for kids. So we need to know that the kids are improving their reading skills. So we need to assess their reading on a continuous basis to ensure that, look, is all of this instruction for individual kids really having an impact, and are the kids able to build their reading skills and reading knowledge? But, you know, Gary talked about stamina for, you know, kids starting in kindergarten through third grade. Are they improving their stamina? You know, were they at the start of this program, you know, we started today, my, you know, kids are reading for a short amount of time. Are they able to build their stamina over time? Are they able to improve the amount of time they're writing about their reading over time? Because those are the things that ultimately have a positive impact on the work that we're doing. And teachers are going to give us that feedback. Certainly, you know, in conversations with the school council, they're looking at what it looks like, not just for our kids that are struggling, but how are our high achieving students doing as well. So those are things that we talk about at our school council meeting as well. So those things, I would say, as far as timing goes, I don't think we ever stop, to be honest with you. I would say I would encourage, you know, the assistant superintendent and anybody who's looking at our instructional practices, if we stop assessing whether things are working, we're going to fall behind. So I think we're going to be looking at it from now and the end of the year in terms of the kids' reading scores, in terms of fluency, in terms of stamina, in terms of the work that they're producing. But I would say that it's an ongoing process to make sure that it continues.
If I can just add, I mean, in terms of this very specific measures, I mean, obviously the state assessments, standardized, our own, I mean, three things come to mind immediately, that our own common assessments that we're using as formative assessments in the district that we're implementing, but then also, you know, administrator observations, peer observations, you know. I mean, if we felt like, oh, we're getting better results, but I saw kids that weren't enjoying, you know, so I just think that's huge to see kids engage, especially in the areas of literacy. I mean, across all content areas. But that's how kids are developing their voice and critical thinking abilities. And so when you see kids engaged in that way, then that's a important sign too. I mean, and some of the drivers too, in addition to the a accountability ratings and so forth, much of it, in my mind, is also being prompted by making sure that we're aligned to the standards. I was just looking at some of the notes that I had in for reading comprehension, for instance, and this was something that our staff across the board has been looking at, that the new standards, the new curriculum that we've been trying to put in place, puts a huge focus on comprehension skills. You know, so certainly the foundation, the foundations, the phonics, the, you know, learning to read, but then the reading to learn part, you know, the standards really put equal emphasis. But there's a sentence that always stuck out to me that, especially in talking to about the pre-K-5 standards, says the framework states, these foundational skills are not an end in and of themselves. Rather, they are necessary and important components of an effective, comprehensive reading program designed to develop readers with the capacity to comprehend texts across a range of types and disciplines. Students must be given the opportunity and access to be able to read widely and deeply from among a broad range of high quality, increasingly challenging and informational texts. And the framework really provides that grade by grade staircase, they show, of what that looks like in kindergarten, first grade, second grade, third grade, fourth grade, fifth grade. And that's the best sort of prep, I think, in terms of tests, that kids have access to that. And one of the things that, you know, I'm anticipating as a district that we'll be looking at is, you know, the classroom libraries, making sure that we have more and more of those texts. I mean, we've even had emails of things, I think through the budget process, people asking how can parents help, and, you know, well, they can't fund a position so much. But I think things like this, you know, getting titles and things as we're beginning to identify different types of titles, that's going to be helpful in not just ELA, but in science and social studies and math. And that's a major obstacle even in the state assessments, the reading comprehension, that even if it's a math test, even if it's the science test, mm-hmm. if the reading comprehension isn't quite where it needs to be, the kid might know the math, you know, the kid might have a propensity towards science, but if they're having trouble understanding what that reading is really asking them to do, that's an obstacle that we want to make sure that doesn't hinder the kids. So, yeah.
All right.
I had one more question. Actually, I just want to make sure, I think we all use our filters and sometimes we hear what we want to hear, and I want to make sure that I'm hearing what I wanted to hear. So, and it's related to your talking about attendance data, because it had been a challenge in the past that attendance data was sort of, you looked at it when you were worried about a child, not routinely. So there were kids that could be very well performing, but who were missing a lot of school. But it didn't raise a flag because they were still considered well performing, as opposed to another child who might have been struggling and it was viewed more as a problem when they weren't going to school. So am I right to understand that you're reviewing this attendance data regardless, you're looking at the attendance data and then looking at the children to see who's missing school and then trying to get a sense of why?
Yes, yeah, so that's part of the law that we have to follow, is that we have to track it on a consistent basis and get to the root of what the challenges are and then find ways not just to know it and share it, but also find ways to support families to help students and ensure that they can get to school, because I think all parents, that's certainly what they want and that's what the school wants. So our job is also to identify and then support the families as well.
I'm thrilled. Thank you.
Anything else from the committee?
Yeah, just one other thing. Identifying kids that are slipping through the cracks in this acuity, they're kids that are just kind of floating through a group setting and maybe not able to engage at the level they might in a different setting. Do you have any systematic ways of identifying, you mentioned stamina is one thing that's a little perhaps difficult to quantify in a group mm-hmm. setting, right? Like, can you really tell if one student can follow the lesson for an average of 10 minutes versus 15 versus maybe more? What are the systems that you're envisioning in the future or ways to identify? I mean, you can look at obviously test scores that change, and they give you this student score last year was this, and you can follow that student through. Are there other kind of internal only measures within the school that you're developing or talking to or teachers are suggesting that would be a way to look at? And you mentioned the after school program in your last presentation. I thought about you. There was about 60 students, I think, in it, and there were a total of 100 students that you'd identified as potentially needing extra support for literacy. So my question is for the, you're obviously doing some of this already, right, to provide added supports to some students that are differentiated based on the need. And so just the question I have is, you know, what measures unique to the way you're building this program and handing it on to your successor, what seems to be working in terms of identifying students that need extra support, making sure that they can access that support, be it after school or some other time?
Mm-hmm. So starting in terms of the kids that get that extra support through, because they've already been pre-identified for us. So the program has built in not only the instructional side of the work, so building their comprehension and fluency, but also there's an assessment that comes with it to make sure that they're ultimately making progress. And so they'll get daily intervention, but if they need what kind of other supports that are necessary, certainly we can add those. So that's part of the program that is for the kids that are pre-identified. The best, I think one of the advantages of this particular program in the classroom, so for kids that are not already identified, by having those individual conversations with students about their comprehension and their understanding of text, we can get an understanding, these are texts, they're provided texts that are at their level, and therefore they should be understanding and be able to articulate themselves in terms of what the text is all about, and they should be able to show their comprehension. And if the teacher meets with a student on one occasion and the student doesn't seem to be able to articulate themselves well, that would, you know, certainly raise a red flag for a teacher. And then if it happens on a consistent basis, well, that sort of gives us an understanding of, all right, well, clearly there's something that's getting lost in terms of the translation for that particular student, and so now we can individually identify them, and then if we have to, add them to the intervention program. But I think this is where the professional trust and, you know, the professional work that teachers do in terms of knowing their kids and what works is really going to come into play.
Thank you so much for all of that. You can leave Reading, but it's never going to leave you.
I'm happy to do it.
Stay in touch, and I know that you will.
Just yes. A quick personal, I just want to thank you for your work at Birch Meadow as a Birch Meadow parent, and what you did for our kids and supporting them there was outstanding, and we wish you the best professionally and personally. Thank you.
Absolutely.
My pleasure.
Thank you, Mr.
Can I just add real quickly that he's not going anywhere yet. He's got a lot of work to do until July.
Good point.
Happy to do it.
Thanks for coming up.
Thank you, Christine.
It's been great.
All right, we're going to talk a little bit about that transition, I think.
So in your packet is a proposed timeline for the search process. We've been using a similar process for other administrative searches. Fine-tuned it over the last several years. It's turned out to be a very successful process. I've always told the screening committee and the community that we need to trust the process and where it takes us, because it really is a series of milestones for the candidates to reach certain places. And what happens is that you do see through the process the strongest candidates do emerge from the group. So as you can see from the timeline, we began advertising the position a couple weeks ago. I'm happy to report, have 24 applications already.
Wow.
As a side note, this is about 3 weeks earlier than 2 years ago when we started the Eaton screening process. So we have received about 23 applications so far. We've got till March 10th, so we still have some time to get some more applications. We've also sent out survey links to Josh Reaton parents and staff about the types of qualities that they want to see in the next principal, so that has been going on behind the scenes. We are in the process also of choosing a screening committee. You could see that the screening committee composition is at the top. It will be facilitated by Jen Bove, our interim human resource administrator. The three administrators that will be on it are Carolyn, Joanne King, and Michelle Shanklin. There will be three teachers, a support staff, and three parents that will be part of it as well. And we have already been asking for volunteers to be on those. We will have the screening committee chosen by Wednesday for the teachers and the support staff and the parents. So we've received all of the applications for that. We will then go through a process as the screening committee of designing the questions. We'll do a day long of interviews. If we need a second day, we will certainly do a second day. We've found over the years that doing a full day of interviews is better than doing it over several days, because the candidates are fresh in the committee's mind as they're deliberating them. And then after the screening committee is done with their interviews, they then move forward a series of candidates to me. I do one-on-one interviews with each of the candidates. They're pre-finalists at that point. The screening committee, because they only see them for 45 minutes, screening committee then gives me questions that they want clarification on, which I will then ask those members. I'll check references at that time. I'll remind the pre-finalists that they would be finalists and they will become public if they choose to move forward. Once they become public, then we begin the public vetting process, and that includes open microphone session with the community, open microphone session with staff, site visit to Joshua Eaton. I have also done site visits to the schools as well of the finalists. And then the hope is during the week of April 10th, which is the week prior to April vacation, we'll have a finalist announced, candidate announced for the principalship. So that's the way the process has worked. I am a part of the process throughout the way. I'm more of a observer during the screening process piece. I listen to the deliberations. I take lots of notes. I listen to the interviews. I do not participate in those interviews, but it gives me an understanding of each candidate. So I'm seeing each candidate, if they make it to the finalists round, I'm seeing each candidate about 10 times through all of the different parts of the process. So that's a description of how it works.
So I think it's a particularly labor-intensive and time-intensive process. But I agree with you. But I agree with you that it is a model that should be used. I think it's exemplary. And many, many years ago, before I served on the school committee, I actually was a parent representative on a screening committee for a principal search in the district. And everything that you just said, I agree completely, that the process really, really worked. And sometimes people who initially you're really excited about, by the second or third interview, you kind of go, oh, there's some stuff there. And then people who are kind of quiet and burst. So you really need to put in this time to really get to know people and see them in different settings. I think it's one, I just think it's an excellent process. And I think we have a lot of really, really strong principals in this district. I have to believe they're connected. We have strong principals because we go through the work to vet them this carefully. So anything else from the committee?
I too have gone through this process, and I think it's spending time to save time. It's really worthwhile. But I also want to make a connection between what Mrs. Webb said before and this, and that was about the use of our time, the allocating of our administrators and our teachers' time, that it's really important that the groundwork that's already been done be used by people who want to get involved and want questions answered, and not make our administrators remake the wheel, because it's time to transition back to our students and making the right things happen. And there's only so much time. And so I really value the time that's put into these processes, and the time that our administrators and teachers get to observe in other classrooms and work with one another. And so I just wanted to reiterate that There's been a lot of work that's been done. I want our administrators to start focusing on these things that are going to impact the quality of the education we can offer coming up, and have all of us who are still processing the budget use the materials you've so carefully created, so that the time can be invested in our students and in structuring the programs that we're offering the students.
Is there a number of first round candidates, like typically depending upon the number of candidates you have in, that you expect to do that first round interviews for?
We pick the ones
that you want to see.
Yeah, we've done 10 to 15 interviews, not on one day. We've split over two when we get to 15. So, you know, depending on the quality of the pool,
mm-hmm. you'll look at as many. And so that's a whole day, that March 16th.
Yeah, that is a whole day.
Whole day of,
that's a whole day.
Right, so I know that's, obviously it's a huge amount of your time during the work day. I know that the parents and members of the community who participate have to allocate a lot of time as well. And I do know a lot of people who are excited to be on these and then say, I can't make that date. And I know people have to really make a commitment when you sign up to do this. You have to make a commitment to, like, be able to make these dates and be part of the process. So
we have found it's easier for someone to take an entire day than multiple
mm-hmm.
half days
mm-hmm.
from their busy schedules.
Right.
That's why we went to the day format.
Yeah. No, I think it's great. I know, again, I never participated, but I know many other people who have and really think it is an exemplar process.
Another question. So I'm wondering, I'm looking at the places where we are posting for these positions,
mm-hmm.
and I don't know a lot, I know some about them. One of my questions is, do we have any feelers out, any postings out in places where we might attract diverse applicants, people that are from a variety of different cultures or different races or different...
Well, TalentEd is the main source that we use, in that there are several people that use TalentEd.
I went to a conference, MASC, and there was someone there that was talking about, she built connections between teachers that have emerged from alternative schools or black colleges or places that aren't just like Reading. And she was from Andover. But I just thought that was a very interesting way to also post. And I didn't know if
I can certainly have Jen look into seeing if there's other things that we can reach out to.
Yeah, I know I was concerned about confidentiality, but since there's probably about 6,000 elementary principals in the state of Massachusetts alone, do we have any sitting principals apply?
At this point, I don't want to comment at all about the pool, to be honest with you. We have 24 candidates. They're of all different types of experiences.
I'm not sure why you wouldn't want to comment.
Because the process isn't closed yet.
So when the process is closed?
I can give more information, yeah.
So when the application is closed?
Correct.
Mr. Marvin.
Can you talk a little bit about how, and I've never been through the process, so.
Oh, you should. It's a good
sorry
time.
Sorry if this is ground, it's the ground we've already covered. But the question is, can you talk a little bit about how we generate the questions for the candidates? Does that just come from the screening
yes.
committee?
There are 10 categories that we use. And they match the standards that we've used over their research-based standards. So, and they hit a whole wide variety of aspects of education. So ranging from family and community to technology integration to active teaching and learning. So we make sure we do one question for each of the categories. The interviews are 45 minutes to an hour long. So essentially, we're asking about 10 questions during the process. We provide questions from previous searches for the screening committee. Each screening committee member takes a category, and they send a draft question to Jen, a couple draft questions based on, and then as a screening committee, we come back on the next date, which you see meeting to design questions.
14.
And then that's when they come up with the final questions. So the screening committee are the ones that are basing the questions and based also on the feedback from the surveys.
So follow up.
Yep.
So do we have any kind of discussion about taking a behavioral type approach to questions? That's a fancy word for saying, you know, asking candidates to identify a specific example from their past of, I had this similar situation, I behaved in this way, the outcome was that, as a way of trying to understand how they might interact with our students and teachers and
yeah,
in our
if
district.
It's not done during that process, it's done during my process.
Okay.
'Cause I have pretty extensive one-on-one interviews with each, and I have a series of questions that I use based on the approach that you're talking about.
Okay.
My memory, and again, I'm going back several years, is that the screening committee did do that. Every opportunity
yeah.
they got, they would throw
a lot of scenarios.
Share a specific
some
example from it,
yeah.
that absolutely
I think that's
happened.
Important to
yeah.
include
it's a
in
challenging
process.
Process to go through when you're looking
Should.
For a job.
Yeah. Anything else from the committee? No. You don't need a vote on this.
On the process, you do.
Oh. Haven't voted in a while.
So, can I move to approve the Joshua Eaton principal search process and timeline as just presented?
Second. Anything else on this from the committee? All those in favor? It's 5-0. All right, I believe this is our last agenda item of the evening, Dr. Doherty.
Yes, it is.
And this is your mid-year update.
Yes, it is. So if you recall, in November, I presented to you the goals, my goals, district improvement plan goals. So really, this is a mid-year update of where we're at. I think probably the best approach is I'll do the presentation and then take
Sounds
questions.
Good. We have a copy. We can jot questions.
Yes, you have two documents in front of you that I hope you find helpful. One is the actual PowerPoint, and two is a bigger document that Courtney Fogarty put together. Which is a visual interpretation of the timeline of the district improvement plan update that was in your packet. Green is complete. Yellow is in process or ongoing. And blue is planned. And I'll talk about that in detail, what those mean. The process that and then I'm going to give you a little bit of the analysis that we've come up with and I've come up with as to where we're at and where we need to go. And then certainly we'll take any questions. So just to give you a little context, we are using the Planning for Success process. That's the timelines that you have in your packet. You have updates in the packet in terms of some timelines are adjusted, and I'll talk a little bit about that a little bit later. And also in my goals, I've given you I added a column that gives you an update of where the progress is on my goals. These goals were developed in the district improvement plan, and the focus areas were developed in the summer and fall. And then in January, we sat down as a district leadership team and reviewed everything as part of our regular process. And so what you see is an update based on all of the work that we did as of January. Also used Courtney Fogarty, who is our data coach, has helped in some of the data that you're gonna see in the development of that data. This just gives you a visual interpretation of our four focus areas, if you recall: closing the achievement gap, social emotional learning, literacy, and mathematic practices. Closing the achievement gap is focus area A, literacy is focus area B, Not the MAC practices, it's focus area C. Social emotional learning is focus area D, with the overall goal being in the middle of addressing the academic, social emotional, and behavioral health needs using the multi-tiered system support of data, systems, and practices. So that's the goal in the middle and the four focus areas. Embedded is the fifth focus area, which is communication. So you will see actually A through E. The E is being communication. And there's the goal, which just talked about. And there are the five focus areas and how they're broken down. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to go through each of the focus areas in a little bit more detail. You have the detailed background information in your packet. You have the visual timeline that I provided for you. So you see is a completed segment is called green. It's the process benchmark is complete. An ongoing can either be, or in process can be yellow. If it's ongoing, initial progress has begun, and some parts are complete but have not reached full completion. If it's in process, which is also yellow, the initial process has begun but some parts are not complete. The reason why I made them both yellow is because depending on the step, some of them are going to have partial completion, others never get to partial completion until the end. But they're all in the process or ongoing of happening. So that's why they both should be yellow. Whereas if it's blue, then that's planned, which means we haven't started it yet. So that's the breakdown of the four definitions. So the first one is closing the achievement gap. Breaking it down, we have five that are complete, none that are ongoing, eight that are in process, and three that are planned. And you can see that's all captured in the actual chart in your packet. Some of the highlights of Action Plan A, which is closing achievement gap. We are using data at each school. I think this kind of addresses some of your questions, Mr. Boyven. And this is what's happening at Eaton in terms of the collection data is happening in all of our schools. We use an early warning indicator system, which is actually provided by the state, grades, progress reports, assessments, office discipline referrals, things like that, to identify students who may require interventions. So that's been happening in this area. Schools are developing and identifying blocks of time called intervention blocks. You see it looks different at each level, but it is happening. Or you're seeing after-school support. You heard tonight at Joshua Eaton, they're using after-school time. They also have intervention blocks. The whole idea is we're trying to shift a way of pulling kids out of regular instruction, mm-hmm. and that they're getting that tier one instruction, but then on top of that, they have to getting additional instruction if they're struggling. And you do that in an intervention block. So that's the shift that we're starting to make in all levels. We are also having discussions at all levels about the levels and sequence of courses. You heard instructional practices happening in reading at the elementary level. We're having discussions at the middle school. And certainly you're also hearing discussions at the high school. Next week we are going to be updating you about some of those changes that are going on at the high school. So that's next Monday's presentation. But those are all things happening under this action plan. Moving on to action plan B, which is literacy. We have the four complete. We have eight that are ongoing. We have eight that are in process, zero plan. So everything is in some sort of stage in action plan B. Some of the highlights, some of this you heard already earlier this evening. The writer's workshop is being implemented in grades K through 5. This is in all five elementary schools to better align with the state standards. Remember that in the state standards, there are three types of writing. As Mr. Martin said earlier, the narrative, the informative, and the argument writing. More emphasis is being placed on the calibration of common assessments. One of the ones that we are really fine-tuning is the Fountas-Pinnell reading benchmark. And it is a future predictor of MCAS performance. So we're trying to align the Fountas-Pinnell predictor as a predictor for future MCAS performance and helping those students that may be struggling and how we can get them more support. There is more focus on reading comprehension, appropriate instructional texts, and the writing-reading connection. And these are all part of the state standards. As we talked about earlier, the coaching support is being provided, and literacy across the content areas is a focus area, including resources to provide nonfiction reading skills to students. The No Adam science curriculum is a major piece of this as well. There's a lot of nonfiction, obviously, as part of that program. Moving on to Action Plan C, which is mathematics practices. We have 3 that are complete, 11 in process, and 14 that are planned. Some of the highlights, and you saw, we had a math presentation, I believe it was January 4th, where a lot of this was presented. The AMC assessments are now being administered K-2 in all schools. This is going to provide us with valuable data to identify where students are in alignment with the standards and students that may need additional support to reach those standards in mathematics. There's professional development going on at both middle schools and differentiated instruction for our math teachers. I'm going to show you some data in a minute, but the number of students accessing higher level math courses is at its highest level. And new secondary math sequences being implemented for next year. And again, during our math presentation in January, we presented that. Here is, since 2006-07, the number of students and the percent of students that are taking both AB or BC calculus. These are basically 11th and 12th graders. You can see over time, 2015-16, 2016-17, that our numbers are at the highest that they've been, and our percentages are also the highest that they've been, 10%, 9.91%. I don't think it's a coincidence that when these students were in middle school is when we started the shift to our standards, the 2015-16, 2016-17 groups. They were in middle school when we made that shift. Here's a graphical version of what I just talked to you about, the last 2 years were on your far right. You can see that they are at the highest levels. Again, this is the number of students in AB and BC calculus. So you could see that the things that we're starting to put in place are working. We all are also seeing higher numbers of the new framework algebra in the 7th and 8th grade. Those numbers are also going up as well. Moving on to Action Plan D, social emotional learning. We have 6 of these are complete, 10 are in process, 5 are planned. Some of the highlights, this year we began teaching health education lessons outside of the regular physical education classes. The S-Bird pilot was very successful in grade 9. Next year, we will be implementing this in 2 grades. We're in the process of having conversations about what would be the most appropriate 2 grades to do this. Our building leadership teams have been now implemented at all schools. I do want to caution you that this really shouldn't just be an Action Plan D item, because the goal is to make the shift and the focus to make this more of both a social, emotional, and an academic leadership team for each building. Some buildings, it's more focused right now on social, emotional. Other buildings have already made the transition, and these will be truly building leadership teams that will look at all domains, not just one domain. That we're taking an integrated approach to looking at the data through these building leadership teams. The building leadership teams, by the way, are teachers, administrators. We do have, in some buildings, a parent and paraeducator are also on those teams. Coaching support is being provided for all these building leadership teams. Actually, tomorrow we have a training for some of our building leadership teams on this. And also, several of our schools have shown a decrease in the number of ODRs from this point, 2015-16, to current. One school I want to highlight is Killam. On the left of the triangle data report is the 2015-16 information. Green is where we want to be more green and less yellow and red, and you can see that at this point now compared to a year ago, that the percent of green has increased, the percent of yellow has decreased, the percent of red has decreased. The green are students that have zero or one ODR, office discipline referral. The yellow is 2 to 4, and the red is 5 or more. So you can see that percentage is decreasing. These are all positive signs, and we're seeing this in a lot of our schools. Moving on to action plan E, which is the communication piece. We have 3 that are complete, 3 that are in process, 3 that are planned. Some of the highlights of this action plan, the implementation of new district and school websites, implementation of a parent portal for easier access to communication. The teachers are implementing the gradebook program at all levels, which is integrated with the portal, which is why we did make the shift to a more integrated student information management system. I began weekly office hours in November, averaging 2 to 3 per week, and have been getting a steady stream of participants, and the topics have been all over the place. Obviously, during budget season, there was a lot more interest in the budget. But parents do come in for other reasons as well, to talk about individual student issues. We've seen an increase in district and school communication via social media. This is in all schools and district level. And we do have an updated student information management system in place. There's another section in your action plan called Early Evidence of Change. So on one slide, I wanted to just show you where we are in the 5 focus areas. Number complete, number ongoing, number in process, number planned. A lot of the data from the early evidence and change is more end of the year data, or data that will be available in the summer. So that's why a lot of these are not available yet. But I did show you some of the data we currently have. So I'll stop there. It's probably a good place to stop before we go into the goal piece.
A stupid question. Sometimes I get lost in the alphabet soup.
Yep.
The SBIRT, what does that stand for?
SBIRT was part of the new opioid law, and it's a screening process.
Okay.
For students that may be at risk.
Sorry.
For substance abuse.
Thank you.
Sorry.
No, it's all right.
I actually don't know what SBIRT stands for. I probably should know that. I'm sorry.
Right. I know we have it, and one of the things that when Sarah made the presentation.
Yeah.
Intervention.
Yeah, I think it's something.
Trying to do it.
Right.
Thank you.
Anybody else on the committee?
Gary has his hand up.
Oh, Dr.
Sorry.
I'm sorry.
I just want to say, so in the packet, though, it's really the data that goes along with what you have on the PowerPoint, but in each section, there's sort of a the benchmarks. I just want to make sure that I'm understanding it right, because there's a lot of information. It's really important because we ask the superintendent to work with you on setting the goals and objectives, and then we are responsible to do those measurements at the end of the year. And again, there's an enormous amount of information here. So with each category, it has what the benchmarks are, right? What will be done, who's gonna do it, when, and then you've added this status column. I'm just looking at, it doesn't even matter which one you're looking at, but A. And then the next part is.
And in the online packet, it's in color.
Oh, okay.
This packet, it's not.
Okay.
So I apologize.
And then the next part is section on measuring the impact, that evidence of change, and it provides specific things on evidence of the change, and they do correlate with everything that's on this big graphic, but.
Yes.
So I just want to make sure that
yes, the timeline that you have in front of you aligns with.
With all of this
yes.
specific information, right? It's just
just want to make sure I was collecting all the data in my head.
Just to refresh your line, the difference between A, B, and B, C calculus, A, B calculus.
Yeah, A, B, B, C is the complete calculus, and it goes beyond the A, B. Probably the easiest way to explain it. So, A, B is the equivalent, they're both AP courses. So A, B is the equivalent of, if you were looking at it as a book, and they had 16 chapters, and I'm trying to just break it down, it's 12 of the 16 chapters, and B, C is the last four.
Okay. And then you mentioned the building leadership teams. How are those comprised? I mean, how'd they get selected, or what's the process?
Those are done primarily by grade level.
Mm-hmm.
And those are building principal decisions, but they are done by grade level.
Okay.
And there are, on some building leadership teams, we do have paraeducator and a parent representation as well. That hasn't been the case in all of them yet, but we're striving to go in that direction.
And one other thing about the social-emotional goal is we have the social competency programs in place at the Rise Preschool and also elementary. Do we track how, what the continuity is, if people are essentially utilizing them to the extent they're expected to? Is there any way to track that to make sure it's occurring?
I'm not following. It Rise?
No, right straight through.
Oh, right. You mean like Open Circle and?
Circle and second.
So that's done primarily through the building principal, but part of what the coaching piece that some of the building leadership teams are getting trained in tomorrow is how can we be providing that type of support in the classrooms through those social emotional learning programs.
Yeah, and I'm not referring necessarily to Reading, but my experience in other communities working as a consultant is that the more academic aspects of a teacher's job, you
right.
know, they sort of put that to the side. And I think it's so important to make sure that it's still maintained.
I agree. I agree.
I just want to highlight on the math that Gary brought up, the AP, that I think it's totally amazing to see the 38 students in the BC calc. It's quite a bit more challenging. It's the class, though, that students can leverage that credit, and leverage a kickstart on their college career. So many students from Reading who are able to take a number of AP classes, attain sophomore status at their universities after the first semester of study because they've leveraged these. So I think that's great. And I know not for tonight, but I'm hoping that in addition to just the increase and the ability to have students matriculate, that we see a better gender profile.
Oh, yeah.
I know the 2012 profile was... was...
skewed a little bit.
Like 100% skewed. My
yes.
sons are in those classes. So I hope that we, get an opportunity to look at that data too, and that, we see improvement there.
I probably should also have mentioned, thank you for bringing it back, is that with the sequence change, this number should continue to go up, which is a really exciting thing to see too.
A number on how many students start, and then I know that in the past they would start, and part of the problem was that then they'd fall off the path because it was too hard or it wasn't working for them. Do we have those numbers, like what it used to be in terms of kids dropping down and what it is now in terms of kids dropping down?
I don't have it in front of me. I think if I remember correctly, when we did the math update, Tracy and the department head for math mentioned that the attrition rate in the last couple years has essentially been zero.
kids are on this path where they, I think he mentioned there could have been one, but if it's been zero. But if you look in the years back, I would have to get that data, I don't have it, but, I mean, even if we had a much higher percentage of students that began that path, you know, in that case, it was being measured by did the students complete algebra in middle school. Well, even if we had 50% or more of the kids who continued that, you know, we were only getting, in some years, 3%, maybe up to 8% of the kids that were continuing to AP calculus. And so, I mean, I really commend all of the teachers that have been working so hard on this, because now to have essentially 2 years where there's been 10% of the kids, that's been a huge difference. And we haven't even implemented the new sequences yet. Mm-hmm. This is really just a matter of making sure that every single student, whether it's in eighth or ninth grade, has a really strong Algebra 1 foundation that is the true rigorous Algebra 1 as aligned with the new standards. And when they are able to succeed at that, that gives them the foundation for success later.
Can you, at a high level, explain how the changes in budget, the cuts that have been made both last year and this year, have affected these goals?
It's a great question, which I'm going to answer at the end,
okay.
if that's okay.
Okay. And secondly, how many of these goals, I guess these started in 16, you have a 3-year window, how many of these, what is different about these goals than the goals that we had prior to 2016? Last set of goals. I mean, I don't, but just at a high level, like, what has been the focus?
If you had to highlight. More goals. We had more, we had a lot more goals. What we've tried to do is narrow down the focus to these four areas with one goal, which is basically closing the, you know, achievement gap using the multi-tiered system of support through these four lenses. And then communication being embedded throughout. What I'm going to explain to you a little bit later is that we even think that what we're doing right now is too much. Some of it's budgetary, some of it's just we don't have the manpower. So that's part of what I'm going to talk about a little bit later. And we want to do it right. So we may have to, and we've already made some adjustments to the timeline. The one that you have now compared to what we had, you know, we had to shift some of the things more into next year than this year. And, you know, one of the, we had a lot of conversation in January as a district leadership team about we just can't keep doing it this way. We don't have, you know, the resources. It's not a complaint, it's a reality. So I'll talk more about that at the end.
Just one comment on the new district school website, new district and school websites, which are much more attractive anyways and seem easy to use. But is there a reason why, and I've only looked at two, why there's no teacher access? It's like you can't, if you're looking for an email for a specific teacher, I'm not finding it on those websites.
It's in the portal, which parents have access to.
Okay, what if somebody from the outside, myself, wanted to contact a, you know, teacher for one reason or another?
So there is a contact page on each,
right.
And that contact page goes to the principal or the school secretary.
Right.
So if you need to, if you're not a parent and you need to contact a teacher, that's the way you would do it.
All right. I find as you know, I work with a lot of different districts, mm-hmm. and it's usually very readily available when you want to get a hold of a teacher at one school or another. I'm just making that as a comment that instead of shifting
sure.
it off into one person, school secretary, that maybe it would be wise just to have it available.
We can certainly look into that.
Can I just, but aligned with that, I know when I was reading the journey, I thought that the email, you did some email guidelines to staff, which I thought was really
That is for staff.
Yes.
The other newsletter we sent out, which went out to the community, was for parents. So we had one for parents.
Right, and I think it's excellent. So I don't, I know, I think, you know, as having been a parent, yes, it was great to have access to the, you know, staff directories and those emails. But I understand. You know, I understand. I'm not always so happy when I'm looking for customer service from someone and I have to, you know, go through that loop of submitting my email first before I get to hear back. But I think it's a balance. I think that was the point. So whatever was sent out to parents to say, this is how to communicate with teachers, and then to the teachers and staff, this is, you know, the good protocol and good practice in regard to email. So I think it's important that we, you know, we continue to work on that, but I think it's important that we have structure that enable teachers to, and staff to handle that aspect of the job, as well as stay focused on the kids in their classroom. So it's a balance.
Dr. Doherty, I really liked this presentation. I liked the format of it a lot. In the past, my memory is when you've done the mid-year update or periodic updates, we just got your goals.
Mm-hmm.
And perhaps we got presentations that I'm not remembering, but I really liked the more executive summary. Here are the highlights. It feels transparent, and if you want to dig into it, we have access to all the details, but I appreciated kind of the level of this. That felt just right to me. A couple of people have brought it up, but there are really some areas that should be highlighted as tremendous achievements. I think moving to intervention blocks as a model is phenomenal. I think the math presentation that we heard with that AMC assessment, that was so exciting to move in that direction. Mrs. Webb already said it, but it bears repeating. These numbers of kids accessing higher level calculus, I don't know how we get a headline in the paper. People don't know this, that right. This is such a phenomenal success for our kids in our district. That is fantastic news. Moving the health education out of physical education for grades 3 through 5th graders, I know is tremendously appreciated. So that just a few things that I reacted to that were really positive. So there's a lot of good here. On the Killam, this is sort of a resource question, you pulled out Killam as an example of where the office discipline referrals, we made an investment in an additional position there, I wanna say a year or two ago.
We did, it was for their therapeutic support program as a social worker.
So that group is probably small enough that isn't related to this outcome.
Correct.
Okay, just wanted to ask
question. However, I think to that point though, what it's done is it's allowed the school psychologist, who was spending a lot more of her time with the therapeutic support plan, now able to do more tier one with the general population. I think indirectly it has had a positive effect.
I immediately went to it in my head and said, yep. We put a support there specifically for this purpose, so that would make sense. A concern I have, and it sounds like you may be getting there, so I won't go there, is under the mathematics practice, there were 14 planned,
mm-hmm.
And that number seems higher than the other action areas. Mathematics also seems to have a higher total number.
Yes.
So that could be somewhat explain it, but I was a little bit concerned. How should I read that is my question. Should I be concerned?
Craig can probably talk more about math. We have been doing a lot of work in math. Don't forget, we made a shift four years ago now. So we started making the shift in math earlier than literacy. So math is at a different place.
Okay.
That doesn't mean we have a lot of work to do in math. Unfortunately, next year, we're going to have to make some more difficult choices based on the resources we have available and based on where the greater needs are in each individual school. So I think that is something that we're going to have to look at very carefully.
One more question, I don't know if you're going to touch on it here, but we did receive a very lengthy email from a member of the public who's here tonight. It's a concern I actually share, and it's around...
I apologize for the length, I'm sorry. I was on a roll.
It was, you really were. and I apologize that I haven't responded, I've been snowed under,
that's
so you
okay.
will get a response
well, you
soon.
You're just clarifying what planned means already clears up half my question.
Excellent.
We always want to keep you in suspense to the actual night.
These packets are like a teaser. I think it's a legitimate concern. Pacing guides, curriculum guides. So can you talk, I don't know if you're going to talk now or later, but can you talk a little bit about...
I can let Craig.
In math,
talk
but also
that.
Across the board,
yep.
Where are we at? Where are we going? What's the plan?
Yep. So essentially in K-5, so K-1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in math and ELA, draft documents were completed in the fall and began being shared with staff.
So the timeline has been kind of moved out because we felt like it's very important as part of the process to allow staff to begin to digest those, give input. We've been making some revisions based on that input. So all of, they now have them, and we still have more work to do.
Across the district, K through 5.
K through 5.
Great.
In math and ELA. And that process has been ongoing. We felt that out of respect to, I mean, we have outstanding staff members who've had wonderful insights into recognizing some of the shifts that these documents are representing, suggestions of how to better capture some of that, and some of that's, you know, things that are missing or need to be changed or format, or there's different things. So, and I think that's ongoing. So the goal would be to make sure that they are public then sometime this spring. And we've also made it clear that the documents, I mean, it's an amazing amount of work that was done, I think, without having people whose job it is to do these these sorts of things in the summer and in the early fall to get draft documents. And we also relied on some help even from other districts who have those types of supports and have been updating their curriculum documents and things. I mean, we really haven't ever had these types of documents before. But we've recognized that they're really, really important to have. We started with K-5 in ELA and math because we thought that was the priority, the two priority areas. I started to say we really stressed that we wanted to create documents that represent where we should be. You know, not in other words, here's what we're, where we are right now, but this is where we should be to be completely aligned with all of the state standards. And that's not to say that they're, you know, carved in stone, even once we put them on the website. One of the things that we've been saying to teachers is that this review process is ongoing every single year. Any good district would be, you know, looking at what's working, what's not, what's, you know, how are we doing in terms of our own assessment data and the state assessment data. What have we learned through the state testing? You know, what are the state focus areas? Are our focus areas the same? Do we need more resources? Do are we, you know, all that sort of stuff. So we anticipate that that process will be ongoing. I know one of the things that Ms. Downey mentioned in her email that I was taking a look at last night is even things that the state is in the process of making some revisions in their own documents. And I don't think they're going to be huge in either the ELA or math. But it's great that the state is engaging in that same sort of process, and districts will be doing that along with them. So the teachers do have them, but it really is sort of out of, not just respect, but just out of the importance of the process, of the expertise of our own staff, to really give them the opportunity to get some comfort level, get some understanding, give feedback, give input. They've had some great ideas, but I want the public to know that, yeah, we've been doing that. But we also struggle, to be frank, you know, in terms of how do we provide the time and opportunities for teachers to really have all of those conversations to do that. And when we do then put them out in the public, I want to make sure that people understand that there's still works in progress. And I think at that time we can give more of an update in terms of how we decided on certain formats and things, you know. Even what I think it was Dr. Doxer was mentioning, the importance of the whole vertical sort of staircase. You know, I keep calling it the relay race that we're in, you know, to work as a team. That it's really difficult, you know, pick a grade, if I'm a fourth grade teacher, to be really, have a sort of an intimate knowledge of what happens in first grade and second grade and third grade and sixth grade and seventh grade. But I need to very easily look at a document that has sort of a cover sheet or over page that says, here are the, you know, primary focus areas in these different content areas, so I can very easily look at sort of how that's scaffolded up, right? And then I think as we continue this, people are starting to see too how our common assessments have to work. We'll also be, we're anticipating that we're going to be streamlining and aligning our report cards for next year to make sure that it matches those priority focus areas that we've identified. Which I think will sort of streamline and help with the teachers' workload that they have, and also even in the understanding with parents that it's the big areas that we really need to report on, not every little detail. So we've been looking at that as well. And even beginning to draft some of those things for the report cards and giving staff an opportunity to look at it, anticipating that some of that shift might happen next year.
Thank you for that. So just to be clear, the plan is ultimately to have them be public documents.
Absolutely.
Accessible by the
yep.
public.
And this spring.
Yep.
On the website. And not through another portal. I mean, Atlas, I think, was mentioned.
I just saw that in the past, and I said, was there anything? I remember on your old website, Atlas had created something, I think, for algebra.
Yeah,
possibly.
And so, and we did have some of them on there with the link. And Atlas doesn't really create product. It's more of a tool or a portal. It will bring in state standards fairly easily. That's something over the years, especially with budget reductions, I'm kind of cutting back in our use because it's a license. And right now I'm looking at probably we're not going to be continuing that because it probably isn't the expense, but we can use our own website to make sure that all of the documents are available. And I think there'll be other ways. I mean, the real advantage of a site like Atlas or others isn't necessarily a housing for documents, but a way for teachers to be sharing resources and links. And I think there are other ways that we can do that via technology without paying, you know, mm-hmm. tens of thousands of dollars of licensing fees. So the Atlas people, if they're listening, won't like me saying that. But yeah.
Or something
yeah.
like that.
Yeah, but they don't really develop a document. That still has to be input with our own work. So we're looking at much more cost-effective ways to do that.
I think your process, I think, is a wise one of bringing it to staff first, because I could see a potential danger if you unroll it to everybody and you find that there's significant areas where revision needs to happen, you're going to have potentially a disconnect between parents and teachers. So, teachers, you know, parents are saying, oh, well, it's the document says you should be doing X, Y, and Z. At the same time, the teachers are saying that's an unreasonable expectation and not a good idea. So some of that revision should happen, I think, before it goes public.
And even people sort of reflecting and noticing, I mean, I've gotten some emails, for instance, from teachers talking about the literacy things and saying, well, you know, it seems, you know, a teacher said it, you know, it seems very obvious that we're putting more of a focus on comprehension reading at these particular levels, which is absolutely accurate, which is completely what the state standards are doing. And so my concern is that I want to be sure that more staff have those opportunities. Not everyone's is able to take the opportunity and say, I'm just going to spend the next few hours and really read through these. So we want to make sure that people have the opportunity to do that. And so I think that's been positive, but it's been slower than we would like.
Thank you for that. Dr. Nye.
So just a comment, having used a document, a software program similar to Atlas, the nice thing about it was getting set up initially, and then, you know, once it was set up, you can print it out and
yep.
scan it, whatever, and say goodbye, and you don't have to use it. The other question I had, though, you mentioned about revision of the extent of information that is, used, presented on report cards. You're going to
mm-hmm.
bring that level back down. Can you, where would that occur? What grade levels?
So, I don't have the specifics yet, but we'd look at all the different grade levels. I mean, one of the things both from staff and from community is, you know, how can that be streamlined? You know, our goal, you know, I've had some conversations with staff about this, that I call it a cover page, for lack of a better word, sort of that brief overview of here's the ELA, third grade standards for ELA. But if you're a parent, you're probably looking, you know, what's the big picture? What are the focus priority areas? What's built upon from the previous year and so forth? Also, we want to list on there what common assessment information do we use as a district to make sure that students are making the progress that we want them to in those focus, you know, priority areas. And so that our goal as a district should be that if we have common assessments also, that they provide the teacher that information, the data necessary to help them complete their report cards. You know, where our kids, are they progressing towards the standard? Are they meeting the standard? Are they, you know, exceeding the standard? So that all of those things are coming together in a much more meaningful way for community and for staff. So I think we're getting closer to that. And I'm not, in some grade levels, there might not be major shifts in the report cards, but it's something that I think across the board that we've received input that we should be looking at, that if we can make it more easy to understand and more streamlined for the teacher, then we should look at that.
Follow up on that is I had a chance to look at a elementary teacher doing their report card. I won't mention who it was, but I was amazed at the number. It was math, I think.
It's a lot.
It was like, I'm like, can you really? Do parents really get anything out of this? There's so much information there. It might be more beneficial for another teacher to look at, but, you know, and then of course, you know, the whole standards-based approach, I think parents are getting more familiar with it, but it's still a struggle for them.
Sure.
They want to see that A, B, C, where you don't see that anymore at the elementary level. And are we going more standards-based at the middle school, or we're sticking with?
No, I don't I don't know what the future will hold. I don't anticipate going to a standards-based. I think some of the discussions that we have been having is more about, it's grades that are more standards-informed, you know, to make sure that the grades that students are getting are reflecting the particular standards. And that seems, that's still a shift, but much more appropriate at the secondary level. So we're still having those discussions, but standards-based grading as opposed to standards-based report cards.
Yeah, go ahead. It's interesting because it's not standards-based in at the university level. You know, it's far from that. And I, you know, think of the conversations I have with my four sons, and it's...
No, there are no post.
Nope, and it's, yep, that final was worth 40% of your grade, and it had three questions on it, and you messed up one of them, you know, and you're mad at yourself, but that's the way it goes. So it's sort of, I think it's a balance. I think I like what you're saying about, you know, where we need to focus in the middle school because, and secondary level, and just to make sure that the grades are calibrated to the standards and that the students really, that it's a good solid assessment and they know what that means as they go to transition from middle to high school and there's a shift in the, you know, maybe the rigor and the expectation, you know, they need to be prepared for that. And I think it's perfectly fine to experience shifts and changes, and they will experience those shifts when they go off to the university level. So, you know, they need to be prepared. Students need to be prepared that they have to be adaptable to change. But we have to make sure that it's valid,
yeah,
and that it's reflective of, you
especially
know, the work
the
they're doing and the achievement.
Too. I mean, being a middle level teacher for so many years myself too, you've got that mix of your teaching kids very important skills, study skills, organization skills, things that are really, really important to their success. But they're not in the it's not in the standards. So how do you capture that? How does that get reflected in a grade, or does it not? Are there other areas that a report card need to be more specific in reflecting? So those are all really good discussions I think we hope to have in the future.
Dr. Doherty, it's getting late and we have more to this presentation, so I'll take other questions from the committee, but let's just make sure there are now new questions. And
yeah.
Go ahead, Dr. Doxon.
I guess my reaction to that conversation was that about the report cards and about what the expectations are in the assessments in college versus in elementary and middle school, and that they need to remain developmentally based, that they need to be informational, they need to reinforce the study skills, like you're saying, and that change is hard. And change needs to be understood. So there's two tangents to that. One is when you are ready to launch to the use with the students, I think it's really important, and I think I heard you say you're gonna do this, that the parents get an intro to that before it's actually implemented so that they understand what's going on. I think sometimes just when the kids hear first or when they don't understand, that it goes a lot farther for the parents to have gotten their own focused introduction on that. And then to fight the urge to break kids in early because they're gonna have to face those tough assessments later. They're not there yet. They need something different now developmentally, and so I appreciate that that's what you're trying to do. Thank you.
Anything else from the committee?
All right, Dr. Dougherty.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Martin, for all that information.
Thank you.
So just a few slides on the goals, which are very related to the district improvement plan. First goal is closing the opportunity gap, which really encompasses the four of the five focus areas. Two of these are complete, one is ongoing, four is in process. And then the professional practice goal on communication. Oh, the reason why I don't have any highlights is because I highlighted in the district improvement plan. And then the professional practice goals communication, which six are complete and three are planned. So moving on to an analysis piece, and we, as I said, we've had a lot of conversations, both as a central office leadership team and a district leadership team, is that we're going to need to reset our pace and timelines on our focus areas. There are non-goal related competing priorities, and again, this isn't a complaint, this is a reality that we're facing as a group. And we're gonna spend some time this summer to prioritize our timeline. We may embed one of our focus areas into others. So those are conversations. We're not getting rid of the direction we're going. I don't want people to misunderstand that. We just are gonna need to reset our pace and timeline. And we're going to also focus on individual schools committing their time and energy on the areas that are the most critical for them at that point. So as looked at by their student and school data. So the other pieces, which, you know, we've had a lot of conversation about this, is we don't have the curriculum leadership support that other school districts have. We're gonna have even less curriculum leadership support next year to work on these multiple focus areas. I know Mrs. Downing asked the question, everywhere that the math instructional coach is listed, who's gonna do the work? The question is, we don't know. And that is going to probably shift the timeline and the pace, and it's gonna look different in every school. And I know that's the answer that the community probably doesn't wanna hear, but that is the reality when you have to make reductions in certain areas, that's what's gonna happen. We wanna do, when we do things, we wanna do them right. We don't wanna have what's called this glitter effect, where things look wonderful from afar, and then when you get up and close and you drill down, nothing is happening.
Yeah.
We wanna stay away from that. So we want to focus on the things that are the most important right now, and then hopefully more resources will become available and we can expand that. We've heard this loud and clear from teachers, we've heard this loud and clear from administrators. This is something that we have to do. So that's something that we're gonna have continual conversations, and certainly we will come back to you with a revised plan for next year. I think another important point in this budget process really highlights it is that, you know, it's, and I'm not counting pre-override, I'm counting post-override, that, you know, we're at 4 months and counting, and we're not done. And, you know, as you saw tonight, we received an amount of questions. We have not received questions yet from the Finance Committee. I'm sure we will receive some from the Finance Committee. So the depth of this year's budget process has slowed down our involvement in the district improvement plan process. You know, one of the things I had on the plan, the action plan in the packet, is we had to stop doing our walkthroughs during the 3 months of the budget process as a DLT, because we had to invest more time into this piece. That isn't something we should be having to make a choice on.
No.
So we're gonna have to be able to shift more of our time from managing to leading. We've done a lot of managing lately. We've got to shift more to leading. so that we can support our teachers and staff to implement the district improvement plan, the pieces that we're going to focus on. So that is really the reality of where we are. I think it's just a reshifting, the reprioritizing. We are, though, and I don't want people to walk away thinking, I mean, I think you see, we are making progress.
Absolutely.
It's not going as fast as we would like it to, but we are making progress. So I think that's...
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, Mr. Bond.
Yeah, thank you for this update. I echo Jean's comment. I appreciate the kind of executive summary format and hitting the highlights. I find that and the narrative component to complement the very granular presentation we have in the packet, I think, is helpful to different ways of different sensibilities, I'll call them. The analogy that comes to mind when I heard the presentation, I looked through the packet, is if you think of a hot skillet and you put a drop of water on it and it bounces around, and every time it bounces, it gets smaller. And so the skillet is the limited resources we have as a district, right? And the drop of water is what we can accomplish, right? And so if there's I think you're hitting all the themes that I think are really critical at the right time right now of prioritizing your last two slides of, like, we need to prioritize, we need to develop depth and expertise that benefits students, we need to be transparent with the community and capture what we think is the best direction for our students. I think we have to seriously look at a plan that, you know, started, I think, in 2015, right, when this was put together. It was a 2016-19 plan, but I'm assuming it was...
Mm-hmm.
Planned before 2016.
Right.
So we've had a series of years of changes in resources that didn't meet level service.
Right.
And so I think, you know, I counted through this, you know, close to 150 different benchmarks in here. It's very granular. About half of those are still in progress, it looks like, when I quickly went through it. And so the question is, how do we best work with our community to prioritize what are the benchmarks, what are the outcomes that we want to measure and achieve? And how are we going to do that? Because we do have certain constraints that I think weren't built into this original assumption. So that's one point. The second, so I'm happy to be part of that process. I think it's the right process, just kind of validating that need to prioritize. I'm 100% in agreement with that need. Capturing expectations and then saying, this is what we can expect, this is what we cannot expect. Very important. Secondly is, when we have a three-year plan, though, and I haven't been through the whole process as much as the other committee members, so anybody can answer this. How do we ensure that we don't have slippage where, you know, I understand that education is a very complicated process. And so we want to set goals that are meaningful, and that requires time and often more than one academic year. But how do we ensure that a goal that we set for 2016, like a three-year time period, doesn't slip from year one to year two to year three, that we're making, in the face of changing circumstances, acceptable progress every year, so it doesn't all pile up in year three and you say, oh, here we are in 2019 in this case, and we haven't achieved any of the things, but, you know, given that we only have 1 year left, we're not going to do everything we said we would do. Like, how do we have those early warning systems early on in years one and two that tell us we're not on pace to get where we want to be 2 years from now, given the resources we have? We need to change the three-year plan. And I guess that's my question. What's built into the system now, or what are people's ideas of what we could add to make sure that, hey, we're in the middle of a three-year plan. Are we on track? Are we not on track?
I think we do that by doing the mid-year and annual review. You're reviewing all those goals. And I think it has been really challenging over the last 2 years because of the cuts. And I think, you know, to John's, to his credit and the team's credit, you know, they, haven't wanted to say we don't want to do these things, you know, we'll take something off the plate. So I think what I see here is a really good evaluation of the fact that, you know, these have to be trimmed back. And we made some extremely hard decisions and serious cuts this year. And so now we really have to, you know, push those, take some of those and say, those are not for this three-year window. They're going to have to go out beyond FY19. So I think from my perspective, and I've been through many years of the superintendent's evaluation, I think the first year that Superintendent Scatini first started the methodology from that the Department of Education put out, we were piloting it. And I think Dr. Darty has a real good amount of rigor in the process in terms of the now the mid-year review and really thorough, you know, self-evaluation and ability for us to take a look at that and, you know, weigh in on what the goals are at the beginning of the year and do that thorough review, right? So we really are reviewing it three times a year because we review, we set the goals and we review what Dr. Darty has provided from for him and the district leadership team, and then the mid-year, and then the end of the year. So that's actually, I think, a lot. But that's the, you know, and I think having each of us be accountable to really look at those details is important and be asking the questions.
I think I'm just summarizing what you said. I do think Dr. Doherty's annual evaluation progress is the big annual check-in. Here's where we're at in the three-year cycle, and Dr. Doherty always provides, and we want him to provide, evidence of progress towards those goals. So that is an annual, in addition to the mid-year, I mean, it's interesting, this is a mid-year, and you're saying it's time to reevaluate. So even during the mid-year process, we can do it. But certainly annually, there's a very clear way where we say, how many goals have been accomplished, how many not, are we on track? And the evidence Dr. Doherty provides is extensive.
Mm-hmm.
If I can just, page five of the district improvement plan. So I don't know what page it is in the packet, but page five, measures of progress toward our goal during the next 3 years.
Yeah.
These are the areas that we'll be monitoring.
Mm-hmm.
See if we're making progress. So I think these are the, and hopefully these are things we capture at least annually, if not more than annually, that will help us.
That's helpful. So do I understand your assessment now to be based on the last two slides? Not the thank you, but two before that. That we're going to see an assessment of priorities by when?
You'll see it for next goal, next year.
For next, that we'll,
yeah.
That we'll see, for instance.
I think you said you're gonna work on it over the summer,
yes,
right?
Yes,
yeah, so in the fall.
We always review our year,
yep,
twice in the summer, at the beginning of the summer, and then at the end of the summer. We do a lot of planning during the summer from the beginning to the end. And that helps set the stage for reprioritizing this district improvement plan.
So we'll see some kind of result from that the next time,
yes,
we talk about goals, and that may include changing some of what was,
yes,
originally in the three-year plan.
Yes.
Okay. It may include taking things off, rewording things,
yep,
possibly adding things, I guess, if possible,
yes,
but a reassessment. Okay.
I think when that time comes, I'd love to see an articulation of what are the non-goal related competing priorities that are pushing, that are related to this. Because I think we need to be aware of that. So I think that's,
yes,
something when we approach that, I'd like a description of what those items are. I want to validate, I quite like Mr. Boivin, I think this is the right time to do this, and I'm not exactly surprised. I'm disappointed, but I'm not surprised. And I think it is the right thing. And I think it is very much, to me, connected to employee retention. If we continue to say, we don't have the adequate resources to do everything we want to do for our kids and to get to where we want to get as quickly as possible, if that means we're asking employees to do too much, we're going to create a whole other problem. So I think we have to be reasonable about what we ask of staff. So I think this is very tied to employee retention.
So. Can I just add, I agree completely. I mean, it also can unintentionally even prolong getting to the very results that,
yeah,
that you want. So I always use the metaphor in my head of, you know, I picture these dominoes that you're trying to orchestrate, that where one falls, you know, and if it really deciding, I need to push, get this one here and really just focus on this one, because when this one falls, it's gonna help the next one fall over, and the next one, and the next one, and really sort of arranging things that way. And looking at other strategies of how can you, if possible, increase your capacity to do that. I mean, I talked about, you know, how we're collaborating with some other districts and looking at some things, relying on each other, and that's happening across the board with North Andover and Wakefield and North Reading and Plymouth, and so, you know, I think many districts are facing some of those challenges. So.
Is it fair to say that the 3-year plan assumed a level service budget for 3 years?
I hope, maybe it hoped for it.
Yeah, I would say that's yeah, good assumption. So to Jean's point, I would also find it helpful if we could somehow capture, assuming what are the assumptions that we have, and if there's any way we can have some guidance on contingencies, and I recognize that's a complex thing, but some high level of prioritization. There's a lot of detail here which is really helpful, but it makes it difficult, and I understand there's a tension between maintaining flexibility to best meet students' needs versus being, you know, I don't know, deciding issues before they arise, right? We don't want to do that, right? But if you can provide some sense of what you view as the priorities for the district of, given a level service budget, this is what we're going to do, these are our priorities. Within these areas, this would be the one or two things that we absolutely have to ensure are fully funded. Because you can't, if you have 10 goals, hypothetically, and you cut each 10%, that could have a disproportionate impact on each of those goals,
mm-hmm.
right? You have the expertise to be able to say, well, with this goal, we don't want to cut at all, because that would have an enormous impact. But this goal would, in my view, have which is the best of the bad options. So, I mean, at a high level, when we look at these, the bullet points saying, look, some priorities, assuming level service budget, taxpayers are going to get this for their tax dollar. Assuming, but within this, our priorities right now are this, this, and this. Any guidance? I wouldn't leave it open-ended because I don't have anything specific in mind, but that type of analysis in a climate to date where we've looked at having to limit our resources, I think it's helpful to understand the impact of that as far in advance as possible.
And I just want to clarify, because you said this, but I think it bears repeating. You aren't looking at changing any objectives,
no.
or going yeah. in any different strategic direction. No. It sounds more like expected pace
Correct.
Of accomplishment.
Yeah. We feel that these yeah. are the right things to do. It's just it's going to take a longer time to do them.
Do we, based on our vote in November? So I'm glad. But I think, you know, when you put dates to stuff, if you don't have the people to do it, then you've
right.
got to be honest. Anything else from the committee?
I just, yeah. To follow up a little bit, I think, you know, the thing that's tricky about, you know, well, we're going to close the achievement gap and, you know, you sort of can't choose almost not to do any one of these items, A through F, let's just say, you know, in terms of, but so it's not like, well, we'll pick up the trash every other week instead of every week. You have to put some effort in. And obviously, we saw this budget cycle how incredibly difficult it is to say, you know, we are not going to do something programmatically for our students. This is Reading. And it's been a struggle. So I just, I worry that we're not going to get out of this budget focus. And it's so essential that the leadership team have the ability to lead and go into the classroom and be with the teachers. So, you know, I think this is a great framework. There's an enormous amount of detail here. And, you know, to be able to have John come back to us, you know, and say, okay, this is what that pacing is gonna look like. But I just feel like we can't keep reinventing. I hope we don't have like 200 more questions to answer on the budget, for goodness sakes, but because we need them to do the work of leading the district. And I'm afraid maybe that we're not doing a good, we on the committee are not doing a good enough job being the guards to allow the experts to do the educational work. So I think we need to be mindful of that ourselves.
I do, but I push back a little bit. Part of our job is answering to taxpayers. And
I'm not saying not.
If taxpayers have questions about the budget, they deserve answers.
I totally agree, and I'm not saying to not do that. I'm saying, but again, I just think there's an enormous amount of information, and I feel like I feel like I know that the people on the finance committee, and I know that they recognize this is their responsibility, they got that, those packets, they will look over all of that data. I would say that if somebody asks on that group, asks a question that's already been answered, it will be an oversight. They would end up being incredibly apologetic because they're gonna do the work of going through that. Now, they are members of a committee that they have volunteered to be on to do this job. All I'm asking is, we really need the public to do that same level of detail, because and we ourselves can maybe help provide some support by providing answers to the questions that we can say, you know what, the answer to this question is on page 27, figure 5. So I just want to be
which ready. I have definitely done.
Yes.
On more than one occasion.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So I just want to be, you know, I think it's you we're talking about educating students where, you know, we're not talking about the difference between picking up leaves or bringing them to the compost, and it's a different thing.
That's true.
I do, just to follow on that, actually, just a resource that I think people have in the public as well as email, an alternative is we do have office hours scheduled.
Absolutely.
Right? So that's another opportunity for, you know, each of us have volunteered our time and learned from reading these very detailed documents, and come to office hours and talk to us, and you know, if that may be a first pass. Dr. Darty has office hours. He's the people on this committee of office
mm-hmm.
hours, and that's an excellent opportunity to sit down with. These are still complex documents, and they're highly granular because
right.
we want to be as transparent. But obviously the challenge then is you have a dump truck full of information, and you're it's difficult to when I first came to it as a committee member, it was a lot,
right.
And I still find it challenging, and so. I'm happy to share with anyone that wants to show up to office hours, and if there's a big demand for office hours, I'm happy to volunteer to do more to help people in the community, you know, get the information they need and the understanding that helps them participate constructively in this process, because we're all in this together for the sake of the students that we're trying to benefit. So sign me up for more office hours.
I think
please show up. Ask
Linda
me questions.
And I have them next on the 6th.
That is our next meeting, March 6th. Mrs. Webb and Mr. Blavin will be here a half an hour early at 6:30, eager and ready to answer any community questions.
That's right.
Anything else from the committee?
I have one other quick thing.
Sure.
Just, I saw this, so Monday, March 13th, it's, I believe, sponsored by Understanding Disabilities. Just talk about
wonderful.
It.
Wonderful. Yeah.
Yep.
Mental health for teens. So it's for high school students and adults, a two-hour presentation. To learn the warning signs of mental health issues in adolescents and teens. And this is a great, especially for people in the community who participate in the youth mental health first aid. This is also a great additional way to sort of boost and keep that training and awareness up. But to all parents, I would say adults, no matter how old your children are, it's sort of to understand what a crisis is, how stress can affect teenagers, what are the symptoms of depression, warning signs of suicide, and how to help a student or a friend. So again, that's Monday, March 13th at 7:00 at the Performing Arts Center here at the high school, sponsored by Understanding Disabilities.
Thanks, Mrs. Webb. It sounds like a good plug-in. Anybody else? I'm sorry. Yes,
I believe there's, Aaron's not here anymore, but Aaron had contacted me about a benefit evening or event at Bunratty Tavern for Samantha's Harvest.
Yes.
On Saturday, March 4th. It's coming up. So
this Saturday.
Yeah, it's a Saturday.
So if you want to attend that, I think that would be an excellent cause that we've worked with as a committee.
Absolutely.
Right.
And it's always fun. Yeah. Always a good time.
Right. And they always donate every year.
They raise money and mm-hmm. our students benefit. Mrs. Downing, did you get the answers that you needed tonight?
I think the only one, it sounds like I was asking about slippage in a lot of math benchmarks, and about Ms. Brown's benchmarks, and it sounds like it's related to budget and people bandwidth, and that's what the planned means, so that, and you asked my curriculum question, so I guess the only one I had was really what I thought was one of your most important benchmarks, which was ensuring our math curriculum is aligned at least with the 2011 standards. And then, so is that committee that you're forming still looking at alignment with the old standards or looking at the new ones that are in draft format? Because I would hope our standards, our curriculum's aligned.
Yeah, so we're aligned to the 2011, which is the most recent state standards. So what the state is looking at now isn't a completely new framework, but there are some revisions.
I've looked at them,
there are several, yeah. And I think actually Ms. Brown mentioned them in the math, some of them, how they relate in math, and there are some in ELA as well. So there are some revisions, but it's not like a completely new framework or anything like that.
Okay, so that's what the committee's doing. I was just concerned about that because it wouldn't make sense.
You're talking about our district committee, or you're talking about the state?
The K-12 math committee.
Yeah, so.
That's in the plan.
The one that was in the plan that got moved, and it said reviewing curriculum alignment.
Right, so one of the parts of that is to have both a literacy and a mathematics district committee, a vertical committee, which essentially, I mean, we have in place, but it's a matter of when we're convening them. Basically, we have curriculum leaders now and administrator liaisons for all those grade levels and so forth. And so some of them have met in by levels, like just, I think I mentioned it last time, fifth grade or the fourth, fifth grade math teachers and the middle school math teachers and the high school math teachers met together. So we certainly are using some of our times and our leaders to have those conversations about the vertical alignment as well. But I think in terms of curriculum review, the vertical committee that we have in place, which is simply essentially representatives from each one of those levels, will be important going forward. It'll be made up of the leaders that we've assigned to those positions.
I guess the only last thing I have, and it'll be brief because I know it's late, back to report cards.
Mm-hmm.
They're not giving out the first elementary report cards until Friday. And if there's anything you guys could do to bring back the fall report card, anecdotally, a lot of parents would be very happy. I think it's very hard to not see an assessment until almost March. I don't think the fall conferences are quite the same, and I think it'll help with not just a place like Eaton, but any kind of looking for students that suddenly are not keeping up with the class. It forces the teachers and the parents to look and say, wait, this person should be progressing towards the standard now, and they're not getting anywhere, and hopefully it's fewer standards.
Mm-hmm.
I really was glad to hear that the report cards will be simpler, but it would be, I don't understand, a lot of our neighbors are still giving three report cards a year. I've looked, it's North Reading and Wakefield and Wilmington, just a few, and I don't know why we went to just the two. I'm just hoping we go back.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Anything else this evening? Anyone feel like making a motion?
To adjourn.
Second. All those in favor? Good night, everybody.